Do it too, baby.
3, 2, 1.
Crack that now.
What you see?
What you see?
Is what you get.
Is what you get.
What you see?
What you see?
Is what you get.
Is what you get.
Hey, yo, what's going on, everybody? Joey C in the place to be. I got a big boom box and a new CD coming at you live from the GFY studios. Here today with my man Charlie, doing the damn thing, playing with cameras and buttons and microphones. Yo. Did you get that new button set up?
Go fuck yourself.
Go fuck yourself.
I can hear it.
He can hear it. It's sorry on the recording.
You guys don't wear the headphones anymore.
We have buttons. Lots of buttons.
Go fuck yourself.
Charlie's in charge of all the buttons.
Sound effects, spaceships, and laser beams.
Exactly, laser beams.
Yeah.
Here today with Kelly and Patrick from Flat Tack Farm. Thanks, guys.
Yeah. Thank you for having us.
We're on. Yeah, man.
Excited to be here.
Yeah, we've been on a Vancouver farmers market slash people who do stuff there and farmer type kick, and you guys were on the list, I think, from the original Jump Street list, and then seeing you here at the Small Eats pop-up last week was like, yeah. Reach out to them. So, thanks for coming.
Yeah, definitely.
Cool. I don't want to get in the habit of summarizing people, so if you can, tell the people who you are and what it is you do, please.
All right. Ladies first.
Okay. My name is Kelly, and I'm a co-owner slash operator of Flat Tack Farm here in Vancouver, Washington. We are farmers. That's the main gist of it. We grow veggies. We grow fruit. We've got some laying hens, some chickens, some ducks, farm cat.
Nice.
And, yeah, we just like to get our hands dirty and create good nourishing food for ourselves and our community.
You like doing it, you said. Right on. I like that. Yeah. You're good.
Yeah. All right. And I'm Patrick. I'm the other half of Flat Tack Farm, owner, operator, farmer. We got all the animals. We grow the fruits. We grow the veggies. Love peppers. As a little personal note, probably my favorite thing to grow. We grow upwards of 50 varieties of hot peppers from jalapeno all the way to Carolina Reapers to things that just come out naturally. And I absolutely love being a farmer. I'm a blessed individual. Yeah.
Beautiful. Yeah, there's a mental note scar burned in my brain about peppers that I was going to bring up later. And we'll get to it.
All right, cool. Sounds good, yeah.
Pepper game is no joke.
Yeah.
Amongst all the other stuff, but it's like it left a mark on my brain.
Mm-hmm.
Pretty cool. Yeah, how long have you guys been doing the farming thing?
We've been farming where we are for 7 years now. This will be our 7th season officially. We had like a little half season in the beginning. And we're just in Northeast Vancouver on the Heathen Estate vineyard property.
Right on.
Yeah.
Yeah, I've been out there. It's a pretty expansive property, big mansion up on the hill, lots of lavender. I was just talking about the lavender when we went out there. It was so what does that sound? It's like, oh, that's a bees in the lavender.
Yeah.
Yeah, that's a pretty cool space.
Yeah, definitely.
7 years, yeah?
Mm-hmm.
Before you just like said, fuck it, we're farming and got some land, or there was nothing before that, or?
I had previously gardened. I've been doing that for, I don't even know, since I moved up here in 2010 from Colorado. Okay. My very first garden I started right before I moved up here. And
well,
yeah, just really interested in trying to grow my own food and learn more about the process of where it's coming from and what all's in it. Mm-hmm. But yeah, and then when we met, we had traveled for almost 2 years, just under 2 years, studying, woofing, working on a bunch of different projects all throughout like Australia, New Zealand mainly, and then also some projects in Southeast Asia. So we kind of wanted to just get in there, learn more about agriculture, and also have some fun and travel and see the world.
Yeah, do cool stuff.
Yeah. Oh, yeah.
Nice.
It was my first time ever leaving the U.S., so it was mind-blowing and amazing and beautiful, and everybody should see the world. The people are incredible. The food's incredible. The adventures you'll go on are just amazing. And yeah, like, who knows how many times you get to go around the sun.
So exactly.
Go have some, have a good time.
Go do the damn thing.
That's right. Yeah.
Was the food spicy enough in Southeast Asia for you?
It was pretty good. It was up there. Yeah.
Did you have an affinity for it before?
Yeah. I love Thai food. Right. Yeah. And actually the hottest Thai food we ate was a Thai woman who lived in New Zealand. She burnt our faces off every time we went there. She's like, "You want Thai spicy?" It's like, "Yeah."
Right on. Are you sure? Yeah. Mm-hmm. Beautiful. Cool. So you guys traveled the world. You did some home gardening and said, "Fuck it, we're going to do a farm." It's like going from like, "Oh, I can make lasagna. Let's open a restaurant."
Yeah, we kind of just
honestly, our name is like the inspiration, right? Flat Tack. In New Zealand, when we were there, we lived with a guy named Eddie. He was from Liverpool, but had been down in New Zealand for a while. And every time we'd see him, he would just be so busy and just going for it, rolling around the property with a wheelbarrow full of wood, picking up, you know, fruit from his trees. Mm-hmm. And that just kind of stuck with us. And part of our name, I'll let him do the accent because he's way better at it. But Flat Tack was like full on, full speed ahead. This is it. We had the opportunity that presented itself at the vineyard. The owner, Sonny from Heathen, has been amazing. And he had bought the property. There's a lot of empty space that's not planted in grapes. And he just wanted someone to be able to use that and turn it into something. So, yeah, that kind of, the universe just aligned. And his good friend works for one of Sonny's companies and hit us up and was like, "Hey, he's got space." And we're like, "Yeah, that's exactly what we're traveling and trying to like figure out. Where are we going to do it?" So it just kind of aligned like perfectly for us right before we got back from our travels. And so when we hit the ground, it was like, time to go. We're going to figure this out.
Oh, you were out of country and then got the call. And wow, that's
Like the last month, I think we were traveling. It was kind of nuts, actually, how it worked out.
Somewhere between 1 and 4 months, but not that important. We kept in contact with my buddy, and just came up. He goes, "Hey, so Sonny bought this vineyard, and he wants a farmer." And we had, like, days earlier been, like, talking about, how do we get land? Land's really expensive in, like, all over the U.S., but especially on the West Coast, especially in the Pacific Northwest. And it was the craziest thing. It was just like 3-4 days later, and he's like, "You guys want to farm here?" We're like, "Yeah, I want to do that." Yeah,
nice.
So it was great. Yeah. And, he already had a tractor, and he has been the best. Yeah, it's amazing, like how helpful he's been, and it's just a mutually beneficial relationship. And
beautiful.
Yeah, it's great to see the land productive.
Yes.
Yeah, rocking. Yeah.
Working with good people is one of the best pieces of business advice I got before I started the restaurant here. Mm. Finding good people to work with in all facets, you know, a good plumber who's a good person too, you know, but you know, somebody that's going to be willing and helpful and wants you to see you succeed, however you want to be successful. Yeah, that's super cool. And having past conversations with some other farmers and whatnot, you know, Lindsay from Sprout and Blossom, who worked with you guys for a little bit, right?
Mm-hmm.
You know, finding land, like you had mentioned, are you okay with talking about your relationship? Like, do you rent the land, or like he owns it and just one of the farmers there? And it's like, "Hey, it's here. You just live on it and work it for us," or?
Yeah, so we're happy to talk about that.
Yeah.
We lease it, and we have, I want to say, 7 years left on our lease.
Right on.
And that's most of that's like tied to some high tunnels we got with a grant. You have to be there for the life of it. But Sonny, like, drop of a hat, we brought him the lease, and we were like, "Hey, we want this because we're getting a high tunnel." And he's like, "Oh, yeah, cool." Signed off. No problem. He's like, "I want you guys there as long as you want to be there."
Right.
And yeah, it's really insane, but great.
And essentially, like, the lease itself, it's just, like, mutual, like, we're just there. And he gets a tax credit for having more land in agricultural use.
Mm-hmm.
So it helps him out because it's a pretty big tax break. The more land you have ag, it's, like, a huge difference on your taxes. Mm-hmm. And so he's kind of, we're just kind of trading that way. And
you have livestock, farm cat.
Yes.
Yeah. Got to get that panther out there doing some fun stuff.
Pretty huge. Yeah. It's been really, really good. And I want to say it's like open-ended, you know. He's he's not like going to be hurt if we wanted to leave, but we have a good relationship and we communicate, and like it's easy to get a hold of him. And vice versa, like we try to. Yeah, exactly.
Very, very nice.
Yeah, we also try to be available as well, exactly, and open to suggestions. Or if he is like, "Hey, can you guys do this or that?" Then we do our best, you know, because it again, it is mutually beneficial. Everyone's trying to help everybody. So
right on. Without that fortuitous situation that occurred, how do you think farming would have shaken out for you as far as finding land to either lease or buy or whatever?
Likely we probably would have just worked on someone else's farm for a bit. And actually, when we started, I did work for a farmer out in Gresham at the same time we started our farm. So it was kind of like two farms at the same time. Okay. And just went full on right into it. But you know, there's a few pretty cool projects in the area. So the farmer that I worked for is on an incubator, and so the county is like East Multnomah Water Conservation District bought a huge plot of land in Gresham, and it's a farm incubator to teach new farmers. Like it gives them the supplies they need, the wash station, the cooling space, the tractor. And then they just have to have a good business plan, and it helps them grow their business in the first 5 years.
What's the name of that one?
It's called Headwaters.
That's
Farm Incubator.
Dan's out there, right?
Yeah.
Yeah, Dan Sullivan.
Yep.
Right?
Well, I think he graduated.
He might have graduated, yeah.
I think he was there when I first started.
Yeah. Flying Coyote, too?
Flying Coyote, yep. Right on. And then I worked for Emily from Full Cellar Farm.
Oh, right on. Cool.
Yeah.
Cool. Yeah. Couple of Slayers. Yeah. That's beautiful.
Yeah.
That project is. I'd love to see more of that. And when Jordan was on here, we talked about that, and he was like, "Well, there's this plot of land right down the road that could be great for that as well."
Yeah,
yeah, we talk about that sometimes too. There's a really good space for that sort of thing to take place, and we are actually talking with one of our neighbors about that. Maybe that could shake out in the future, but it'd be
beautiful.
Yeah, in the distance, but he's interested because he wants the land to be farmed as well.
Nice.
Yeah,
and you know, it's hard with farmers aging out. A lot of the kids and the children don't really want to be farmers, and so all of this land just ends up, they die, and it just ends up getting sold to developers typically.
Look at Rich,
kind of the thing with Joe's. And I mean, that's just kind of what's happening, but I feel like there's been a bit of a resurgence in the last 5 years, 10 years, with younger farmers doing market gardening and making a living from it. So
good.
Yeah.
Yeah, that was a couple conversations we've had in the past about, you know, other generations not wanting to be farmers because, you know, they can go dance on TikTok and make $1 million or whatever they want to do, play video games or something that's not farming and super arduous and takes all your time and you may or may not make any money to make a living. Yeah, you know, you see businesses closing all the time, but the farms and dairies and cheesemakers shutting down because the family doesn't want to do it anymore. It's tough to see. From my perspective, as somebody buys from those people pretty consistently, it's like, wow, that one, they're not going to be around. That was such a good fucking product.
Yeah.
It's not going to be around anymore.
It's like it's the double-edged sword because it's a beautiful thing to have it while you have it. And you know it won't last forever, but it's kind of always shocking. You're never ready for something to go away. You're like, man, they were around forever.
Yeah.
They've been great always, you know? Like, and then one day, like, we buy hazelnuts from someone in Salem, and they had a death in the family, and it changed the dynamic of the business overnight. And they're like, all right, you get one more chance to buy. Okay. Yeah. Bought a few cases, throw them in the freezer.
Yeah.
You know? Yeah.
That most recently, the Ricer Ranch, you know, selling and get out of town.
Oh.
You know, super thankful that Windy River picked up their lamb game and they're going to be taking that on. But that was something I was like, man, we've been buying from them for 8 years now.
Oh, yeah.
It's like, boom, it's gone. It's like, whew, that's a tough dig.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
Yeah, man.
It was surprising for me. I had no idea.
Yeah.
It seemed like they were doing really well. But, yeah, I mean, sometimes people just need a change. So I get it.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah.
For sure.
Yeah.
And I feel like kind of revisiting your earlier question, if the thing with the land we're on now didn't work out, I think we're both pretty tenacious people, and we would have found a way to grow food. I don't know that it would look the same at all, but it's what we like to do. It's super rewarding. It is really hard work. Like, there are days that just break you, but you wake up the next day, you do it again, and it feels great. I mean, you look around during the golden hour, and everything's ripening, and it's shiny.
Nice.
It's just like, mind-blowing. You don't need anything else but that. You're like, wow, I'm tired, but I feel awesome.
Yeah.
And so it's, yeah, it's, our friend Denise calls it practicing life. She leaves work and helps at the farm to do that. And I was like, that's a really cool way to put it. I like that. Yeah,
that's good.
Mm-hmm. I've got a few friends that do that. They help us when they're not, you know, doing their 9 to 5. They'll come out and just spend a few hours, just get some fresh air and connect.
With hands in the dirt. Yeah, it's a beautiful thing.
Yeah.
I highly recommend it for human beings in general. Mm-hmm. What do you call it, Charlie? What do they call it in the gaming community or the online community when you get outside?
Oh, touching grass.
Touch grass. That's the phrase, yeah.
And then I've heard forest bathing, and which I think is a pretty fun term. Yeah. I'm like, I think that's hiking, right?
Yeah.
Yeah. I don't know.
It's a more fancy version of hiking, but.
I mean, it sounds prettier, yeah.
Forest bathing.
Yeah.
Touch grass. Mm-hmm. Yeah. I could dig it. I like all those things.
Yeah, absolutely. Right on.
So it is arduous work. Like you said, some days will break you and whatnot.
Oh, yeah.
How do you keep going? What makes it so good, you know? Selling, you know, 100 pounds of potatoes.
Yeah.
Woo, I did it, man. I'm going to go do this again tomorrow.
It's kind of hard to put my finger on it, but I think it's just that it's sort of like a never-ending puzzle. You get a little better at it all the time, but there's always something new. Like, it's the same thing, but it's new. There's new varieties of stuff. New food, new veggies coming out. Like, they're the same thing, but with a twist on them. And then, like, with fruiting trees and things like that, you get to see them grow and they have their own life. And they go from, like, this little bitty thing to a big, huge, like, specimen of a plant, you know? And it's amazing to see. It's, yeah, I don't know. Like, I just feel like I'm in the flow of life more when I'm doing it. And so... when we come into the city or we go out to a show or something, I definitely notice after farming for a while, like the shift in energy and like the way you feel is very different. And so, it's something you have to like, for me, I have to be mindful of and sort of like mediate it as it comes in. Yeah.
So, it's because you're mindful of it. You recognize it. That's maybe the first part.
Yeah.
A lot of people are just like, well, this is what I do.
Yeah. Right. Yeah. And so, I really appreciate it. I think it's, hopefully it makes me a better person and keeps me humble and interested in life.
Yeah. Beautiful.
Yeah.
Well put.
Thank you.
How about you?
I'm definitely inspired to just, I mean, eat the produce. And that alone gets me through the day. I'm like, okay, well, while I'm out here working my butt off, I'm just going to eat this cucumber and it's going to rehydrate me and like give me more energy.
Nice.
But definitely just the flavors. There's so many varieties I didn't even know existed until I became a farmer. And it's incredible, like, just being able to cultivate that and keep it going. I mean, I don't even know how many thousands, maybe even going on, like, hundreds of thousands of varieties have been lost in the last 100 years. They just don't exist anymore.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. So just kind of knowing, like, what we're doing not only feeds us, and we get to connect with the earth, we get to eat and enjoy the like tastiest produce that, you know, sometimes I'm blown away every time I'm out there. I'm like, wow, this melon is incredible. Like, you can't buy that anywhere, at least not that I knew of.
Yeah.
So that, I feel like that's a huge inspiration. And then going through the process of like seeing the seed, planting the seed, watching it grow into a full, beautiful plant, you harvest it, you eat it, and the whole cycle begins again. It's pretty cool. And also being able to share that with other people, just connecting people to their food and where it's coming from has been another factor that definitely like connects me and makes me want to keep doing it for long term.
Yeah.
The appreciation we get from people at the market is, it's cool. Like people are just so excited about all the new things we're bringing. And I don't even know how many people every day were there come up and say, wow, your stand is so beautiful. And I'm like, the veggies do everything, man. I'm just putting them out there.
Right, yeah.
So, I mean, it's humbling, too.
Mm-hmm.
But, yeah.
Beautiful.
Yeah.
Farmers are the new rock stars. I love it.
All right. We're not as well paid, but that's okay. Yeah, that, you don't do it for that anyway. Yeah, you're paid in different ways.
Like exactly.
Kelly said, flavor is a huge thing. We both do love to cook. And so I think that helps us. If we weren't foodies, it'd be hard to keep farming. I feel like it's got to kind of flow through your life in many ways, to like keep wanting to do it. Or at some point you'll be like, this is too hard, I'm done. Because the money you make from it and like within hyperinflation and all those sorts of things that you can't control. Like it's just, it's tough, but you know,
hyperinflation.
Yeah.
Mm. Yeah. Yeah.
We need like Ritalin for our inflation. Huh?
Well put.
Some.
Yeah. Definitely. Interesting. Yeah. I was just having this conversation with JoJo upstairs about stuff. I was like, that used to cost me this, and now it costs me this. And mm-hmm. her eyes were like, I was like, you know, you buy stuff too.
Oh, yeah.
Across the board. And it's not going down. It's never going to be $15 for a bag of flour again.
No.
It's only going to go up.
Yeah. Yeah, exactly. Once you make that much, you can't go down, right? Yeah. I mean, yeah.
No, it's true. And we have to raise our prices too, because wages went through the roof real quick. And that's like where all the overhead is, labor. With any business, but in farming in particular, the sweat equity is pretty important. And so that's where the vast majority of our expenses are eaten up, is in labor. And so things change. We're trying to be flexible, though. If someone wants to work with us, like just shoot us a message and say, hey, this is what I can pay. Like there's usually extra. We try to be reasonable, you know, with that sort of thing, because it does affect everybody, like you said, across the board. Yep. So, yeah.
And we're all out here to support each other, really.
Yeah.
I mean, it's a small community. That's the huge part about being able to connect with everyone else.
Yeah.
Help each other out.
Keep the dollars in the community.
Oh, yeah, absolutely.
It's a big deal.
Mm-hmm.
Right on. Yeah. You talk about people. Do you have employees then?
Mm-hmm.
Right on.
We typically have 2 farmhands at least. Last year, I think they were both part-time. This year, we're trying to get a full-timer and a part-timer.
Right on.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Cool. You entertain any woofers or anything like that?
Not yet.
Right on.
It's definitely been kind of something we've thought about, but the hard part is you have to have a spot for them to live, typically. Like, usually they need somewhere to stay.
Mm-hmm.
So we're kind of trying to figure that out.
Bring your own tent.
Yeah. That's true. They could camp.
Say.
I mean, in the summer, we've done it.
Yeah.
It's pretty nice.
Absolutely.
Yeah. That's true. Yeah.
Yeah.
Right on.
Yeah, it's pretty good out there. But yeah, I would be open to woofers, but yeah, it's one of those things for me that's probably like touchy, because it's like, we don't own the land, and like how many people you want out there, and yeah, certain.
True.
But Kelly did just buy some acreage in Cathlamet, and we will certainly be entertaining woofers there as we put in an orchard and some more like perennial food producing plants. Yeah,
nice.
Yeah,
what town was that in?
So I got 20 acres outside of Cathlamet, which is, you head up to Longview, go along the Columbia towards the coast.
Okay.
On Highway 4, and it's probably an hour, 15 minutes from here.
Right on.
So not super far, but not super close. And it's just like this teeny tiny little town right off of the Columbia, towards the coast on the Washington side.
Good soil and all that stuff?
Yeah. Yeah, it's got good soil. The spot we're at is a little more like wet in general. It's just more wet out there. So we're kind of trying to mitigate some of the wetland areas and do some plantings, like native wetland species. Mm-hmm. Do a huge permaculture orchard that'll eventually be like a U-pick.
Right
a lot on. Of berries, some pretty fun fruit trees.
Mm-hmm.
Nice.
Persimmons, probably. American pawpaw. Have you ever heard of pawpaw?
Oh, yeah. I'm familiar with pawpaw. Yeah.
Yeah. Get some of those, because they don't mind a little bit of the wetness, which is cool.
Right on.
Yeah. And then
blueberries.
Blueberries, yeah. Yep. Mm-hmm. Big blueberry patch. Of course, it'll have to have some, you know, apples and other things.
Yeah,
but
all the things.
Whatever can handle a little more wet.
Yeah.
So.
But yeah, that was a cool feeling when that all went through. Like her and her siblings sold their home in Colorado, and and she reinvested in the farmland out there.
Right.
So that was really cool. You're like, oh, that's like
we had been looking for before we even started farming at land in Vancouver, and it's insane. Like over $100,000 an acre for just flat land, nothing on it.
Yeah.
So.
For some grass.
Yeah, I got kind of lucky, you know. You put it out in the universe, and it usually comes back in all the best ways. So,
Right on.
Yeah.
So how's that look, driving an hour plus to go to the other farm?
Last year, it was a little challenging, but I actually hooked it up so that my mom can live there, too. So it's kind of like a spot for her, because she just retired.
Mm-hmm.
They raised her rent up in Seattle. And was like, I don't know what I'm going to do. I was like, well, we'll figure it out.
Yeah, nice. Yeah.
So we set it up and installed, like, the well, the septic, got a house out there for her.
Mm-hmm.
And it is honestly one of the most beautiful drives, so I don't mind it.
Nice.
I mean, the I-5 part is I-5, yeah. But once you get onto the back road, it's just gorgeous. I mean, literally the other day, I was driving and I saw probably 4 bald eagles, seals, like, there's just so much wildlife. It's incredible. Right on the Columbia there.
Yeah.
Beautiful.
So, it's a cool drive.
Yeah.
I love it.
It is really cool. Yeah. Just, and this time of year, it's like gushing waterfalls as everything's like saturated and just running off the mountains. So, yeah, it's pretty rad. Yeah.
Nice. Yeah. Beautiful. Congratulations. Yeah. How long until you will start producing off of there, you think?
So, right now, we're kind of waiting on some grant funding to try to set up this orchard in a way where it's not going to be tilled and it's not going to be like completely removing all the topsoil, which is, it's got some grass, some canary reed grass, which can be pretty invasive. And so we're trying to figure out the best way to like work with that in the most natural means, but it may take a year or two of tarping it to kill that grass and then replant it. So I'm hoping in the next 5 to 7 years, we'll get some fruit.
Some berries. Probably.
Some berries.
Yeah, the pop are kind of slow, but it's all right.
Yeah, I think they're like 8 to 10 years until they produce. Yeah. They're kind of a long-term investment, like nuts, you know?
Yep. It
takes like 10 years.
Exactly.
Yeah, very similar.
Yeah.
Right on. Mm-hmm. So you got some time and some work and all the things in between.
Yeah.
Oh, yeah.
Sounds good.
Yeah, we're trying to get a tractor between then and now so that you know, the humans can have a little break. Yeah, that we're installing an orchard is a bigger endeavor than like market gardening, I would say, for sure.
Yeah. Dig it. Yeah. You had mentioned grants twice already now. Grant writing can be a big part of farming. Mm-hmm. It can make you or break you sometimes or take you to the next level.
Yeah.
What's your experience been with grants?
So I've definitely looked into quite a few. I feel like we've been pretty fortunate. I've gotten the farm itself. We've applied for probably 5 or 6, and I feel like we've gotten at least 4 of them.
Nice.
Yeah.
That's beautiful.
Mm-hmm. So we've had pretty good luck. I mean, it definitely takes some time. Getting it all written down and stating it clearly, getting all your budgets done. It's a lot of work.
Oh, absolutely.
Yeah, and I, you know, I'll kind of hit it up with, like, some friends and just get their feedback, like, hey, does this sound good? But I've never, until we started farming, I had never done anything like that before. Mm-hmm. So, it's been kind of a learning process.
Yeah, I go, you know, just talking to JoJo up there about business and stuff like that, I try and give my information to people who need it just because I've done the process and in it. But I always found it weird. It's like, oh, you're a farmer and now you're a grant writer too. Have you ever done that? Nope, we'll figure it the fuck out.
Right.
You know? It's like, okay, the fly. And it could be great, you know, getting that grant and that could really change your whole business over. You know, and working with Red Truck, I know she is proficient at grant writing and has got some of them and can really, you know, change the whole look of the farm. That building was not here before. It's like, oh, we got a grant. Now we have a whole new packing house and all this other stuff.
Right.
That changes, you know, you're going to make X amount off of that grant you just got.
For sure.
Big time.
Yeah.
It makes a huge difference, especially for farmers. Like, I think as a farmer, one of the biggest problems is like the capital.
Yeah.
It's like really hard to save up the money to put something in when you're kind of living like produce to produce, check to check, market to market, you know? Yeah. So a lot of farmers, when they start out, are still doing their 9-to-5 jobs. And so it's kind of like hitting that balance can take a bit of time, and a lot of people never figure it out. And you know, most farms, especially new farms, don't even last 5 years. It's like, it's pretty within the first 3 to 4 years they're like, nope, I'm done. And it's sad because there's so much good food and so much demand that, like, if we're going to have an equitable food system that is sustainable, we have to have small farms.
Agreed.
In every city. Even rooftop gardening, like
Agreed.
It
just makes sense. It's like all around. There's like no way it doesn't make sense, you know. And it's but you could come at it from any angle if you're marketing it, you know.
True.
But yeah, you know, this, everyone worried about climate change. It's like, well, produce your food closer to where you consume it, you know, and reinvest in those systems. In fact, innovate those systems. Install vertical gardens in urban spaces. Like, reuse your water. Like, I mean, water can be used, I don't even know how many times, you know, for growing especially. Yeah. And so, and there's many, many designs and incredibly clever people with good ideas out there. And we just like, I don't know, we got to find a way to fund them.
Yeah.
Because that seems to be the barrier to entry. It's always money, right? Yeah. And so, same with farming. Yeah. We dumped all the money we had saved from New Zealand when we came back into starting the farm. And yeah, you find out quick, you need to learn a lot of jobs. And we just, every year we just kept more money in, more money in, we need more infrastructure. And so, yeah. But little by little, it's all coming around, you know? Right. But yeah, Kelly's amazing. She's like, she does kick butt, man. She's gotten this, like, all those grants. And then I like to build things. So for me, it's like, I'm happy to roll in and do that and try to get it done. Yeah. But she's awesome. She's like, again, very tenacious is the word.
Right on.
Yeah. Yeah.
You said you've written 5 grants and gotten 4 of them. Average grant. How much time do you have to throw at that to make it like, hey, I'm cool to submit this. This is viable. I'm probably going to get this.
At least a couple weeks, I would say.
Wow.
I mean, some of them are a lot easier. Like, there's grants that are like $1,000, a couple $1,000.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. And it depends on what you're doing. Like, for organic farming, there's a lot out there to help you get that. We actually aren't certified yet. Long story short, COVID.
Yeah. Well,
yeah. Essentially,
that was my list of things to ask.
They weren't accepting farms when I had finished my application. And then by the time, like, they reopened and were accepting new farms, I was like, well, I don't really want to do 1,000,000 papers again. Yeah. I don't have the time right now. Mm-hmm. So eventually we might get back to that. But we still follow all the same methods. And so, you know, it's just a piece of paper.
Agreed.
Yeah. Yeah. For big farms, it makes sense. You know, they need some regulation. But I would say, so some of the grants are super simple. You know, you really just talk about who you are and what you want to do. Mm-hmm. And do a rough budget, or like try to get your budget as accurate as possible. Some of the other ones, like the TILF grant, is one we got in the past. And all of the USDA grants take a lot more planning. And to be successful, like, we have not been successful yet with a USDA grant. But there, hopefully this year we'll see some more coming out. And
what would be an amount?
The USDA grants are huge. So there's a couple different ones. Like, the main ones that farmers usually go for are the value-added producer grant, which it's anywhere from, I want to say, $50,000 to
$150,000. Word.
Yeah. But it's, right, it's huge. So, I mean, you've got to have a really good proposal and be super, like, on it, get a really good budget, make sure you've shown that you can get this work done within a year.
Mm-hmm.
That one we haven't yet applied for, but it's in the future. Like, if a farmer wanted to do market research or just anything to add value to the raw product, jams, jellies, like hot sauce, anything, that's kind of like what it's there for. It's to help them level that up.
Mm-hmm. Nice.
Yeah. And then the TILF grant is pretty cool. It's more of a local, like, Washington TILF.
Okay.
They do up to $10,000, and It's a lengthy application. You have to have letters of support. Mm-hmm. You know, get people in the community to help you out. Write a letter. They know you. You're legit. You're not just taking some money.
Exactly.
But, the first one we got was $10,000, and that was for when Lindsay first came out. We all used that to try to fund us going more organic, getting more equipment, and just, you know, doing it in a sustainable way.
Beautiful.
That helped a lot.
Mm-hmm.
That was very needed.
It's like a giant grown-up adult book report. Like, hey, here is my presentation packet. I filled out all the things.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
Yeah, it's a lot of work.
Yeah, with all the budget projections and, like, if we invest in you, are you going to be able to make money? Is this really a worthwhile thing? And this and that.
Just like pitching to a bank or anything else.
Exactly.
Like that. Mm-hmm. I mean, it's just, what is the bank? Yeah.
Yeah.
I could dig it. Yeah, yeah. Just had these conversations. Good.
Yeah.
Reinforce these conversations. Jojo, listen to this too.
Yeah.
This applicable to what we're just talking about.
There's like a lot of small business grants out there too, especially for newer businesses. I haven't really delved into too much of that, but I know there's quite a few.
Yeah.
Yeah.
There's resources out there. Something I steer people who ask me about starting a small business too is SCORE. You guys familiar with SCORE?
Mm-mm.
Could you pull that up, please, Charlie? There's even the SCORE Southwest Washington, too. S-C-O-R-E. I forget what it stands for, but it's retired executives or something like that. So they have specialists, too. So let's say you want to start a small business and you need help with QuickBooks.
Oh, okay.
You could find your local SCORE chapter and schedule on a one-hour free – it's all free appointment with this person who was an expert in QuickBooks. And you get an hour to pick their brain. And you can do it 10 times, and it's all the things.
There we go.
That's awesome.
I think it's a really cool resource. Ours worked out really well. When I was looking to learn how to do QuickBooks, I scheduled it with it. And the QuickBooks master or mentor was our accountant.
Nice. Okay. Nice.
So the way he showed me how to use QuickBooks was the way he liked to see how stuff was entered. So it was like seamless transmissions. Like put in everything like I showed you at the free 1 hour meeting. I don't have to charge you for it. And then your books are going to be solid. And it was like,
that's awesome.
It's been kind of smooth sailing because I do the input of that stuff, but he does the accounting on the back.
Oh, yeah.
But if it's clean and neat, you don't have to mess with it.
Yeah, there's no phone calls. Like, what does this mean?
Exactly. Yeah, 100%. But yeah, definitely score, I think, is a.
To look into that.
It's a great thing.
Heck yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah, we don't do QuickBooks, but that has been a huge, becoming a business owner, like you don't realize how much like bookkeeping there is. Oh. And yeah, that was definitely been one of the things that I'm like, okay, I got to figure this out. Like I'm okay with budgeting, but like the bookkeeping side of it is, it's a whole nother animal.
Yeah.
I mean, it's literally like another job.
I mean, people,
whole nother person.
People pay a bookkeeper and they pay an accountant. Sometimes they're the same person. Sometimes they're two different firms.
Mm-hmm.
You know, having 3 hours with Chuck, the accountant, I am the bookkeeper. I don't have to pay one. Yeah. I do all the bookkeeping and he looks at it once a month and, you know, does the accounting part of it.
Yeah.
Nice.
Saves you a bunch of money. Plus, I get to stay really connected to the books.
True. Yeah.
I was like, hey, I spent this much, but I know when I enter it up, QuickBooks pulls it up. You know, you paid this much, this was the last check. I'm like, why is it so much different?
Yeah, you got eyes on your cash flow.
Right on it. Nice. Yeah, it's it's good to be that in touch with it.
Mm-hmm.
You know, is it work? Yeah. Do I come here on days when we're closed to do it? Yeah. But I'd rather be... have that connection to it, then farm it out and and pay. But, you know, sometimes you pay for convenience still.
True.
For sure.
There are professional grant writers out there. It's like, hey, this is a grant. You know, it's like, well, what is it, $10,000? I get 10%. It's like, fuck. Time versus money.
Might be worth it.
Yeah, exactly.
Oh, yeah, we're finding that out more and more. Like, the more years you do it, you're like, all right, what am I outsourcing? Because, like, I don't want to do that.
Yeah.
Like, I've learned a lot of skills. We both have many, many skills and good at lots of things. But sometimes you don't have the time or the desire to do it. Mm-hmm. Like, I don't want to work on my car.
You know?
Let someone else do it.
Time is currency.
Yeah, exactly.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, man. If you're spending time on it, that's your currency, you know?
Mm-hmm.
You could spend 10 hours on it or pay this guy $100 to do it in an hour.
Yeah.
Or a person to do it in, you know, whatever.
Oh, heck yeah.
It's a...
That's been a learning curve for me lately. Like, I'm a huge DIY. Like, I've always wanted to, like, I'm going to learn how to do this. I want to learn myself. I don't want to pay anyone. But as I'm getting older, I'm like, damn, time is life. Like, how much of my life did I just waste doing that?
Yeah.
Okay, well, I'm definitely going to hire someone.
Learn.
Yeah. Yeah, because you don't get that back, you know? And that's 100%. The thing sometimes we don't really think about or, like, connect, but...
Mm-hmm.
So, but there's also the budgeting side of it. Like, you got to balance it.
Yeah.
And I still, like, love knowing how to do all of these things myself. Because when the shit does hit the fan, or if you're just ever in need, like, you got to know how to do some... You got to have some skills.
Oh, definitely.
Agreed.
Yeah. It feels nice to rely on yourself. Be like, oh, you know, whatever happens, we'll figure it out.
Yeah.
And, owning a business, no matter what avenue of business you're in, will teach you that.
Agreed.
And through you, will become resilient.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Right.
And in the age of information, you know, it's like this electrical thing doesn't happen. Well, I could YouTube it and... Oh, I could do that now.
Yeah.
Oh, yeah.
You know?
For sure.
That old YouTube University.
Yeah.
Good stuff.
It's a beautiful thing.
Yeah. Oh, yeah. Yeah, it's great.
Yeah.
Like I love woodworking, and I follow like a few woodworkers on there, and you're like, oh, that's how you do that faster, you know? And then, and like you said, that's that skill. It's now all that time it saves you, and the result is better, you know? And it's amazing. Yeah.
Yeah.
That's the favorite part of technology. It's probably YouTube University, you know?
Like,
yeah.
I love it when, you know, I don't say I love it, but there's sometimes when you have to pay somebody, you know, electrician come in here and, you know, wire this place.
Yeah.
I was there watching him the whole time.
Mm-hmm.
Nice.
I was like, how are you doing this? What are you doing? I'm gonna pick it up, and then next time, you know, I'm going to try it myself. Electricity, not so much, because, you know, I'm going to fry myself. But
And permitting. You know.
Yeah.
Whatever.
This is 100%.
Yeah.
Good to go permitting. Inspected by the fire department and everything. I got this card and stamp. No, it's all good to go. Yeah, learn how to do that shit yourself. And that is part of any small business, whether it be farming, pizza shop, widget making. Mm-hmm. Shit's going to break. You can spend the $500 to fix it or do it yourself. You know?
Oh, yeah, definitely. For sure. And sometimes, like, realizing that something costing more up front saves you tons of money in the long run. Like, buy the better tool.
Oh, yeah.
buy the good tool, you know, like, because it's more expensive for a reason, you know.
It'll last you longer.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I got plenty of Harbor Freight tools.
Oh, yeah.
I got some stuff. It's like, well, I'm finally buying this one over here. I could have bought it up front for all these three over here.
Right.
Yeah, yeah, that's great advice, too. Mm-hmm. Yeah. Budgeting too. Sometimes you got to meet in the middle, but
oh, absolutely. Yeah,
this is where to get the good tools.
Definitely, yeah. Strike a balance.
With Harbor Freight, like, if it doesn't have moving parts, you're cool to get it at Harbor Freight.
Yeah. Yeah, that's what our buddy told us.
Yeah. If it's got moving parts, maybe you might want to get that somewhere else.
That's great. I like that.
Yeah. Yeah. I was like, yeah, that's totally true. I've had a lot of, you know.
Well, you know,
things last for 6 months, and you're like, damn.
Or, you know, you buy a jigsaw, and it won't turn off, which is pretty important. You know?
Yeah. No plugs.
Yeah. The rapidly moving blade.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah. The blade with no off switch.
Yeah.
That's what it said right on the box. Yeah. Ah, it's $20 cheaper. I'll get
right,
that.
Yeah, right, yeah.
Bananas. Yeah, man. Wear lots of hats as farmers and business owners.
Mm-hmm.
It's yeah.
Good.
Yeah,
cool.
Most definitely.
So, this is a question I ask many people that come in here, but I find it really cool to ask people who do super arduous physical labor mm-hmm. all the time, 7 days a week. What do you guys do for recovery?
I used to rock climb.
As a recovery?
I mean, it's different, I guess. It's just like you're moving in the opposite direction, which I still love climbing. We just we both had some repetitive stress injuries that we're trying to like rehab, and so I haven't climbed since my birthday at the end of September. But I love doing that, and then also yoga, just stretching, and then sometimes we go to Connect Wellness, and we do the sauna and the cold plunge. Yeah, yeah, and yeah. So just a variety of things, but definitely it's usually just more movement, which might seem strange to some people, but
motion is the lotion, man.
Yeah,
you gotta keep moving.
Oh yeah, and I've always played sports, so I like things that are challenging, they're hard. They're like, you feel good afterwards. You know, you don't feel good at the time of doing it. Yeah. And then how about you? What do you like?
For me, wow. Acupuncture, massage has been really helpful. I actually am dealing with some more chronic injuries. And another reason for us hiring a full-timer is to take my place, essentially, in a way, so that I can fully heal from some of the stuff I got going on.
Okay.
But acupuncture has been awesome. A lot of it's nerve-based, so I've got some, like, nerves pinching and...
Where at?
Thoracic outlet syndrome, so, like, nerves...
Hands numb?
Pinch, mm-hmm. Your hand goes numb.
Swells up.
Circulation issues. Like, it's gotten to the point where, you know, especially in the end of summer when you're harvesting all the time, mm-hmm. The constant bending really gets me.
Yeah.
And that definitely is, like, the big proponent of it getting worse. So trying to figure out how to move properly. Mm-hmm. A lot of postural stuff.
Yep.
Open stretching is huge. Yeah. So
as you said, I'm saying, I can do that too.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. Yoga and stretching. But I mean, a lot of people I've talked to, it doesn't really ever go away necessarily. Mm-hmm. It's all just about managing it. And, you know, I hold a lot of my stress in my jaw and my shoulders. That's like where my stress is. So trying to like, just get that to chill out. Mm-hmm. Trying to do be a little more mindful with like meditation. I don't do it a lot. I would love to do it more often than mm-hmm. I actually do. But yoga too.
Yeah.
Even just a hike in the forest. You mm-hmm. know, just get out and
forest
walk.
Forest bathing.
That's right.
Forest bathing. Do that forest bathing and, you know, just let it all go and take it all in. Also.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
Let it go and take it in. Yeah. Out with the old and in with the good.
Yeah.
That's beautiful. I have the, I don't know if it's the same, but similar situation. Like, first thing you did was point to your neck, and I was like, hands numb. And I was like, I know that one.
Yeah.
Went to somebody for it, and it's like, my hand's numb. I was like, yeah, it's in your neck. I'm like, no, it's my hand. It's like, throws his elbow on my neck. I'm like, that's the most uncomfortable thing ever.
Yeah.
But I could feel my hand.
Mm-hmm.
Keep going.
Or you get that trigger point, and it's like, let me push here, and my hand will go numb. I'm like, yep, that's the one I need to work out.
Yeah, that's the one.
It's so common, too. I mean, mm-hmm. a lot of people don't realize they have it, but they're like, why the hell is my hand going numb? The first time it happened to me, this actually started probably before we met, 12 years ago?
Yeah, something like that.
10, 12 years ago, and I was told I had carpal tunnel. I also play guitar, so like, when that first happened, I was like, oh, yeah, carpal tunnel. I've never had carpal tunnel.
Yeah.
It's always been in my back and neck.
Mm-hmm.
So the whole body's connected. It's been an interesting process for me to like go through the whole diagnostics and like, ooh, what affects it? Where is it coming from? And just how everything's connected.
Yeah.
It's pretty crazy.
Yeah, that carpal tunnel really took off there for a while. I was like, oh, you're sitting here at desk. It's your fucking
neck, dude. Oh, yeah. Posture. Yeah. That's a big one.
My pops had, you know, neuropathy and whatnot and got some elbow shade and everything. And I was like, it's in your neck.
Yeah.
So come here. I was like, wow, it feels so much better. I was like, rub this CBD product on it and do that stretch and you'd be good, man.
Nice.
Yeah.
It's funny how it's connected. I guess it's not funny. It is connected.
It is connected, just don't realize it.
Exactly.
Mm-hmm. I mean, I've been going on like a deep dive this last year into like self-healing, self-care.
Oh.
So I've gone down the rabbit hole. But one of the cool things, I just learned about like the neuro pathways and how they're connected with your body. Mm-hmm. And so you can do certain movements. Like we'll say, my shoulder's hurting. Okay, well, if I like straighten my posture and push my neck a certain way, oh, my shoulder doesn't hurt anymore because you're activating like the neuro pathway and also other muscles. But Z Health, there's a guy on there, Doc, I don't remember his name. I'm horrible with names.
Charlie.
Z Health?
He's got the thing.
I have delved into that in the last probably 3 or 4 months. And
is that the one JoJo recommended? She said Zuckerberg. I don't think that was.
Oh, no, that's Zach Bush. Zach Bush. Zach Bush.
Right on. Mm-hmm. Okay, Z Health.
So, yes, YouTube, Z Health, he's got so many cool videos, but it's all about the mind-body connection.
Right on.
And I've kind of been really delving into that because I've tried so many things with my arm. Mm-hmm. I'm like, this isn't helping, and it's still here. What's going on? But
everybody, Dr. Cobb back with you. I get tons of
random videos for. I mean, he's got stuff on everything. Like you can literally train your eyes, and you'll have a greater range of motion. Mm-hmm. It's crazy. Like it's fun to test some of the like nerve glides and things that he has on there, and it's amazing how much your movement
nerve
changes.
Nerve glides, right on. Flossing.
Flossing. Yep.
I follow somebody similar on the internet. It's like, hey, Gary, how do you reset the blah, blah, blah? He was like, on me or somebody else? He was like, do this, push his fascia, breathe, twist. I was like, fuck, I'm going to do this in the shower so nobody fucking sees me. Fucking breathe.
Or the smash in your face.
Yeah, it's bananas. It's all connected. That's great you got to it, though. Yeah. Is it something you're like, hey, this works, I'm doing it?
Yeah, so we've kind of implemented, before every workout, we do the Z Health warm-up. Mm-hmm. And I've also worked with a friend of a friend who's a health coach this last year. Uh-huh. And she's been helping me figure out, like, my diet. Mm-hmm. She does, like, everything from, like, your environment, the amount of light you're getting, mm-hmm. what you're eating, the balance, I mean, everything. But it's called, her name is Jade, and she's the pro-metabolic. Like, she's my coach. I've been working with her for about a year now.
Right on.
And just really deep diving into what's going on with my body and reconnecting, and it's been pretty incredible.
You getting any blood work with that, or just...
Yeah, I do. I work with the naturopath, too, and have gotten full panels. And
I just got a reason why I ask. I've gotten lots of panels, and I try and analyze all that stuff. I'm going to do this, that, and the other thing, but I recently got a genetic methylation test.
I was listening to that, and the... I have both. There's two MTHFR, like the methylation pathway, genetic, like, I don't know if it's necessarily like a defect, not a defect. I don't want to call it that.
Gene break, they call
it? Gene break, yeah. I have both.
You have both of them.
Oh, I found it out actually like the hard way. I was getting cuts on my hands and they would just not heal for like 2 weeks. And I was like, what the hell is happening? And, you know, I've had like some inflammation stuff with my body. And so at that point, I saw a naturopath and my B12 and my D was so low that I had to get like prescription for a year. And then it was like, oh, okay, I feel better. Like things are healing again. Mm-hmm. It's crazy the connection like it has with your whole body and your whole system.
Yeah. Both the motherfucker gene breaks. Wow.
The motherfuckers.
Yeah. You take a TMG for it at all?
I actually just looked that up when I was listening to your talk with JoJo. I didn't even know about it until.
Yeah. I don't know if it's like a cure all for it, but.
Yeah.
That's one of the pathways. It's like a $12 bottle of 60 pills.
Yeah, that's I got to look into that.
Yeah. I just got my results back and I got a meeting with the naturopath to go through it. I mean, it's a 15-page report of fucking science gobbledygook. And I was like, I'm going to Google all this and try and come in as prepared. She was like, yeah, it took me 15 minutes. I'm like, thanks. But there's lots of triangles and circles and gene things. And we'll see what shakes out. But That's interesting. You got the test and, you know, two gene breaks.
Yeah. Yeah, I had the test. I don't know. This was probably before I started farming, actually.
Oh, many moons ago.
Or, nice. Like, when we started. So it's been about 7 years, and pretty much I've just tried to make sure that I'm taking, like, the methylated version of all of these things. And whether, I don't know if it's necessarily staying up there. My last test seemed all right, so.
Was that, were you guided there through a naturopath? Like, hey, you're going to this methylation?
Yeah, so, working with a naturopath.
Going to a, you know, traditional doctor, and I was like, hey, blah, 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 what about a, you know, motherfucker test? And we're like, genetic like, methylation? And they were like, hang on. And they called somebody in, and I was like, this is like the supervisor. And I was like, I just heard about it last week.
Oh, my gosh.
You know, your naturopath was on that tip many moons ago.
Yeah.
These doctors are not taught nutrition or other ways of healing, and that's cumbersome.
Yeah. And I mean, yeah, I've literally been prescribed an anti-inflammatory, and I'm like, that's not what I need. Yeah. But for right now, I'll take it just to, like, get it under control.
Yeah.
And, yeah, the last person I saw, I tore some stuff in my elbow. This is the second time it's happened, which is unfortunate. But he was like, yeah, just take a ton of ibuprofen. And I'm like, nah, nah, I'm going to go see someone else. this is not what I need. And it was a physical therapist.
Just a bunch of them. You'll be good.
Yeah, exactly. You've got to take the rest of your life. And then they
can give you a pill for the first thing you took, you know, that caused another problem.
To the other problem, yeah. To the side effect of the pill.
All the anti-inflammatories that wreck your belly. Well, then we'll give you something else for that.
Yeah. You said you don't want to talk about politics.
We won't get into that too much, but.
Yeah,
I could dig it. Yeah. Yeah, taking advocacy for yourself and advocating for yourself and fucking, hey, finding somebody you can work with that listens to you when you talk.
Right.
Finding the right way. That's good you do that.
And part of it, like, farming and growing my own food was part of that. Like, okay, I didn't grow up with anyone in my family that grew food. I mean, my grandma had chickens, but my mom loves growing flowers. More power to you, but I never had food growing up that was, like, grown ourselves. So it's been kind of new, other than the eggs. Like, you know, when I was straight out of high school, college, I was like, ramen is my diet. I'm going to eat ramen because it's cheap and easy. And all the package of food you eat, like, you know, what were we talking about the other day? It was, pastaroni. Do you remember that?
Yeah. Pastaroni. That was not allowed. Not allowed in my
that
house.
That is not allowed. But, I mean, I grew up with a lot of the convenience foods. And, like, my parents, my grandpa ran the Coca-Cola. So when I was, like, 2 years old, my mom tells me this story that when I was 2 years old, I would ask for Coca-Cola. And I'm like, a two-year-old drinking Coca-Cola? Oof. What? No wonder my teeth are so messed up. No, I'm just kidding.
Oh, like Rice-A-Roni. Pasta-Roni.
Yeah.
Pasta-Roni, Rice-A-Roni.
Maybe Pasta-Roni was the sequel. I don't know.
The sequel.
Yeah.
Right. But it's like everything you need is right there. You just throw it on the stove.
Right on.
Throw it in a pan. You're good to go. But, you know, the problem, obviously, with a lot of this stuff is there's a lot of additives. Horrible things that humans should not be eating.
I guarantee you it's a fucking ranch flavor.
Ranch gotta flavor?
Be something adjacent to ranch.
Adjacent.
Okay. No, that's true. The food additives are like no joke. That's what Kelly's been learning a lot in her metabolic eating classes. That even if you switch, like say you're in a keto diet and you're eating these like keto friendly things, they're full of thickeners and gums, which apparently destroy the lining of your stomach, which allows leaky gut, which then makes things that were already hard to digest harder to digest. And if you look, you'll see that there are, like, gums in almost everything that's packaged.
So I was, like, lactose intolerant for a while. Mm-hmm. And it took me a while to figure out what it was that was, like, bugging my stomach. Cheese. And so I would eat vegan cheese because, I mean, you can't just not eat cheese. I mean, you could, but it's miserable life. Yeah. No, I'm just kidding. Not that bad.
We've had many cheese conversations.
Yeah.
You're
so,
right in the pocket. Keep going.
Yeah.
You're right. And for the longest time, I was like, I cannot have yogurt. I cannot have cheese. No milk. Nothing. And after meeting Jade, the pro metabolic life coach, you know, going through her classes, it's like xanthan gum, guar gum, carrageenan, any gum essentially, like locust bean gum. All of that just destroys your gut lining. And so it was kind of funny. I was eating vegan cheese, which in turn was like a catch 22 where I couldn't eat cheese ever again because it had so many gums and other binders to like make
emulsified oil. Yeah.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. Make it like cheese like product. And so I was literally just making it worse. Mm-hmm. And then I know with Jojo, you guys talked about Zach Bush and the ion supplement. Mm-hmm. So in combination with like cutting out all the gums and then doing that supplement and just trying to be a little bit more strict with my diet, like I cut out a lot of seeds and nuts that are really hard to digest, which was funny because like that would be our go-to snack. Like, oh, yeah. I want some nuts and some mm-hmm. fruit when you're like working on the farm, just quick and easy. Yep. Mm-hmm. And it's, yeah, and it was just making it so much worse. So after doing that with the ion supplement for what, I don't know, 9 months maybe? Mm-hmm.
Something like that.
Cutting out gums, I can eat dairy no problem now.
Word.
Everything. Yeah. Like not a, well, mozzarella still gets me sometimes.
A little bit.
But I don't know if it's yeah. the mozzarella or something else.
It's a vast improvement. Yeah, every yeah. if there's only one, that's pretty good.
Yeah. And I mean, like, I know you were chatting with someone about like GMOs and wheat, just wheat in general, mm-hmm. and how modified it is from its original mm-hmm. form, that a lot of people have crazy sensitivities and allergies to it now. And a lot of that is just like already your gut's compromised. Mm-hmm. And then you're eating something that is like more bred to have like corn and other like grain in it in the same thing. It's just yeah. really hard for your body to digest. It doesn't know what to do with it. It's never seen it before.
Yeah.
Yeah.
We haven't evolved to, you know, be able to handle that yet.
Yeah. Modern wheat is at least 6 grains and grasses bred together, which is, I don't know, a little bit of Frankenstein plant. I mean, we all, like all growers, do selective breeding, mm-hmm. like where you pick the best specimen for different characteristics and traits.
Or cross but, 2 different varieties mm-hmm. to get a new one.
Exactly.
That's normal. That's all right.
But yeah, yeah, definitely the gene splicing is very different. And I mean, who knows? Time will tell what it does. But definitely it's not, modern wheat's not easy to digest for the human body. Yeah. But also, there's a lot of factors that go into it, like what they're treating it with. Because mm-hmm. if you're spraying yeah. poison on it, poison's poison.
Yeah.
You know, yeah. There's like yeah. no getting around that one.
Yeah.
Yeah. So.
Yeah. I mean, if you take, you go to XYZ pizza, you know, chain pizza place, and you get this, the dough is made with flour that's been sprayed with all kinds of stuff and maybe yeah. has some kind of preservative in it. The sauce has some kind of preservative in it and, mm-hmm. you know, citric acid. And yeah. the cheese is a low quality that is an emulsified oil. And then a meat you put on it is highly processed. You're just consuming so many fucking processed ingredients in one fucking meal.
Yeah.
And that's over a week, over a month, over a lifetime.
Yeah.
It's a wonder why you got to be on these drugs for the rest of your life now.
Yeah. It's amazing. There's a lot of, like, ancient wisdom. And I think it's like an Indian saying that says, let medicine be thy food and let food be thy medicine. You know, it's like yeah. an Ayurvedic saying.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah. Ayurvedic, yeah.
Mm-hmm. And it's like, well, yeah, like not every body is the same. Mm-hmm. So what is good for one can be bad for another, yeah. Which I think is like the ethos of holistic medicine in general, is mm-hmm. to treat each individual as like an individual. Yeah. yeah. Like you are your own little unit. Yeah. And, like, yeah. and like you said, someone who will listen to you. But yeah, yeah, it's... it's pretty amazing, yeah, when you think about, like, that's, they call it the sad diet for a reason, the standard American diet, right? You know, yeah, it's like, yeah. But when you learn to cook, you realize also that, like, things taste better when you make them yourself and when you seek it out, and maybe there's an energetic exchange as well, like putting some intention and effort into that thing you prepared.
Absolutely.
But, like, you don't have to get woo with it, but just the factual part is that it's better, you yeah. know, on all levels, yeah. Mm-hmm.
Yeah. Grandma's apple pie tastes really good because she fucking loves you.
Yeah, right? Yeah. Right,
yeah. Pouring that handmade love in there.
Exactly.
Yeah, definitely. And like,
I agree.
Yeah, and like when someone makes something and they're thinking of that person and like, what do I think of? Like when I think of this person, like, mm-hmm. I want to cater this to them, even if I miss the mark a little bit. Like, I want to make sure like that's what's in my mind while yep. I prepare it. Yeah.
Being mindful. Yeah. Mm-hmm. You know, I do it daily when I'm rolling out dough. I make sure I'm in a mm-hmm. good place. It's not only what I'm doing, but it's how I'm doing. You know, mm-hmm. hey, how you doing? Not good, no bad. I'm doing dough. Mm-hmm. It's not what I'm doing. It's how I'm doing.
Yeah.
And, you know, there's 1,000 things going on. You got 5 different things cooking and, you know, life is going on. Mm-hmm. Yeah. I'm doing dough right now. And this is getting my full attention. I'm very mm-hmm. mindful about it. Because, yeah. you know, some kind of transference may or may not occur, but I think so, maybe.
Yeah. So, oh, definitely. Yeah.
And you guys touching the earth and touching the the literal raw ingredients of things that are going to become nourishing food for people. I mean, there's transference on so many levels.
Oh, right. Absolutely.
You know? From the kid, you know, it's like, oh, I'm going to just throw these over my shoulder into the thing. It's going to get a fucking bruise, dude. Give it a little some fucking care for that thing.
Oh, you know? Especially like when it's harvested green and then trucked and shipped, and it's like, well, yeah, this life never developed really. Like all life feeds on life, you know. It's just that it's you can use like, yeah, it's cycle, but it's everything's a fair exchange, mm-hmm. even if it seems unfair. It's all trading off, and so yeah, mm-hmm. Certainly when you take something before it's ready, you're not going to get much from it, which is kind of sad, but.
Showing reverence for it and everything. It used to drive me, I don't want to say drive me nuts, but, you know, in kitchens you get in, you know, a specimen of a halibut. Mm-hmm. And some cook comes up and is like, wow, look at this. Whack. Yeah. Fuck, this fish fucking died and we're going to serve it to people and you're fucking beating it up when it's dead. It's like, don't ever let me see you do that again.
Yeah.
Any produce, you treat it with fucking reverence, you know?
Yeah.
Be nice to it. Yeah, somebody's going to eat this.
Absolutely, it's the thing that's going to nourish you.
I mean, right? Yeah.
Yeah. And it's funny, like, I talk to my plants 100%.
Oh, yeah.
Energy is huge. And, you know, what you're putting out there is what's going to come back to you. And I wholeheartedly believe, like, positive vibes. And I talk to my plants and show them as much love as I can. And, I mean, it's literally been proven. Like, they've done tests on plants and, like, the effects of music, like classical.
Absolutely,
And they are receptive to sound. They are receptive to energy. Everything is. We're all just the same carbon atoms, but we're energized by the sun and a lot of other things. It's all related. And, yeah, being a little more in touch with that has been pretty cool on the farm and just trying to be more mindful. So part of my struggle was, like, there's so many things being a small business owner and a farmer. It's just, like, there's a million things I got to do. So I've really been trying to work on, like you were saying, being more mindful about, like, this is what I'm doing right now. Mm-hmm. I'm going to focus on this. I'm going to give it all of my attention, all of my energy, all of your love, essentially. Yeah. Like, it's going to be awesome, you know? Mm-hmm. And it's not only does it just make you feel better, but it I feel like it definitely carries through into the final product.
Agreed.
100%.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. Multitasking is overrated. This is what I'm doing right here, right now. I'm being mindful on this right now.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
That's one of the things I love about doing here. I mean, yeah, we got lights and screens and shit like that, but like, no phones, no fucking distractions. Like, hey, human beings making connection and having mostly undisrupted conversation.
Yeah.
Right.
That's for sure.
You do that with your vegetables or your pizza dough or your kids, all the things, you know?
For sure.
It's a good thing.
Yeah.
Word. That's good. So how are you feeling? I mean, you got some chronic stuff you're working on, getting better, making progress, you know, getting somebody to work on the farm.
Definitely making progress.
Oh, yeah.
You know, it's been tough. It's like I went through a small breakdown in the fall just realizing, like, my God, my body's not doing what I want it to. I can't farm anymore was my thought. So I've been really learning, like, okay, I got to manage this thought because it's not necessarily true. I can still do things. I might just have to do it a little differently. I got to adapt myself. Exactly. Mm-hmm. We as human beings are very gifted with adaptation.
Absolutely.
We can do anything we really want. Mm-hmm. We just have to figure out, like, the best way to do it for your own health and personality even. Yeah. So it's been a tough journey, but I'm feeling good about it. And, you know, I'm going to kind of take the back burner this year a little more, do more of the marketing, communication, like do the markets.
Always work, yeah.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, but it'll be different. It'll be different, but, you know, it's all right. It's temporary. I, you know, once I figure it all out and heal a little more, I can go back and do it again, get back in it.
Having have a bit of perspective on it, I'll share my perspective. You can get to a point where, you know, you can hire somebody and you're not working in the business, you're working on the business.
Right.
You're on the outside doing tweaks and doing accounting and all the things. Yeah. Some days I want to put my hands in the dirt. You could still do that, but being on the outside of it, it could even be a kickstart for the business too. It's like, hey, these 3 hours I spent on working on the business made this other stuff happen as well.
For sure.
So. Yeah.
Definitely. That's kind of how I've been feeling about it. I'm like, this could be a really great thing. Yeah. And, you know, like you said, because then you have time for self-care. And yeah, it is changing, like, your relationship with the business, but almost it's like a growing up sort of thing.
Yeah.
And Yeah, we've had other, we were speaking with some other business owners as well, and they were kind of giving us the same advice, and I was like, oh, I guess that means we're on the right path.
Absolutely.
Like, I really appreciate it, because you do need to hear it more than once, because there's all kinds of emotions associated with the thing you've done for 6 or 7 years one way. And you're like, okay, now we're going to change it. And you're like, okay, it's a little weird, but we're going to go with it. Yeah.
But I mean, as a business owner, and I even knew this before I even started or even ever even dreamed of being a business owner. Like, I had no idea I'd be a business owner ever in my life. That just didn't really occur to me, but I had read books and I'm like, well, you know, you have like the person working on the business in the business. When you level up to the point where you're growing the business and it can function without you being there, that's when you're like a true business. Because right now, and one of the big things that I was struggling with was like, if I'm not there, the business isn't there. Like, if I injure myself or something, that's it. Mm-hmm. You know, like, you have to hire someone. There's no other option. So, like, kind of getting to the point where you can hire someone, you've got the stable budget to pay someone, you can move up and actually start growing the business in a different way really how you can make it sustainable.
Definitely. And it'll, I think, we'll find a lot of efficiencies, which I imagine what you discovered, too, is, like, moving to that sphere is that you can improve a lot of your processes so that the time you're spending is more valuable. Like each hour makes more money. Yeah. So like, I'm pretty excited.
A shift in perspective.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Some days it was even quite literal. Like, I stand here and do this all the time. Somebody else is standing there doing it. I'm standing over there and see it from a different perspective. I'm like, fuck, let's go over there and be like, oh my God, that makes so much fucking sense.
Right. Yeah. One little thing. Yeah. One little thing. It's funny. Yeah.
But then even more steps back. It's, it can be a bit of a psychological thing too. Like you said, like, hey, I'm not there. So the farm isn't working, but you're still there, just different capacity.
Mm-hmm.
Right. The identity you have is like, I'm Flat Tack Farm.
Yeah.
Well, you are, but you're also these other things too.
Mm-hmm.
Right.
You know, how you choose to identify, you know, I was pizza guy, but I'm all these other things as well. I could be pizza guy still and all these other things.
Mm-hmm.
Just something I'll throw out there because if you haven't, you may come across that.
Yeah.
As well.
Yeah.
It's we are a business and it is us, but we are many things as well.
Yeah.
It's all connected.
We got a lot of hats to wear.
Oh, yeah.
Definitely.
Absolutely. I thoroughly enjoy winter because a bit like what we were talking about earlier, like loving the thing for the sake of it, I would work in the winter. And it's like, I can just do that for like hours and I get to focus fully and entirely. And it's drastically different from what I normally do. And and the earth's resting, and so for me it's just like I don't feel pressure or guilty because it's like, oh, you know what, I can go do spreadsheets and planning in the evening, doesn't matter. Yeah. But I think it is important. The longer we've done this, the more time I'm willing to give to things that are enjoyable just for the sake of them. You know, it's not like I definitely don't like slack off, but it's like when I do them, I fully do them. I'm not thinking about 100 other things.
Beautiful.
You know? Yeah.
That's a great place to get to from my perspective. I think it's good.
Yeah.
Nice.
But it's still mental gymnastics all the time, every day. Life's
walking down
not
the street.
Simple.
Yeah.
It's a
2-ton vehicle coming at me right now. It's a gymnastics thing.
Right.
You
oh yeah.
Process in your head.
For sure.
Yeah, man.
Yeah.
I could dig it.
Oh yeah.
Right on.
Yeah.
Cool. So you guys, business-wise, you guys do CSA, correct?
Yeah. The farmers market membership, CSA, or community supported agriculture, and then restaurants. And we have one produce grocery store in Portland, Rubinette.
Oh, right on.
That we sell to.
Yeah.
Yeah. But yeah. Mainly right now it's CSA and the markets.
Cool.
It's like our main.
Yeah, and we'll be doing Saturday and Sunday market this year.
Nice.
I think starting in June. So May we'll be there on Saturdays. Mm-hmm. And then as things roll in, we'll do both days. Restaurants have always been good. But I think like after COVID and all of that, like everyone's still figuring out how to do things and coping with expenses. And people are busy. Their businesses are changing too. And so it's like not as robust of a revenue stream, but the market is fantastic. people are great. The people that run it are great. It's just a really cool, buzzy place to be on the weekend. And so, yeah,
we're gonna,
yeah, do both days.
So you guys are, you know, you sell there and are proponents of it. How has your farmers market journey been? How long have you been doing the farmers market?
We started.
When did we start?
Was it the end of our first year?
Oh wow!
I think so.
Got right into it.
Yeah.
We were, well, actually, no, it might have been the second year we started farming. At first, I was really hesitant. I was like, well.
It was the second year.
Yeah, it was the second year. Second, we were kind of hesitant because we were like, well, it's kind of expensive, which isn't. It's not at all. But, you know, when you're starting, you're like, oh, no, $50, what? It was kind of silly. And then we were just like, well, I don't really know if we have enough to bring to the market. That was the biggest thing. Like,
yeah,
we were really small scale when we first started. Mm-hmm. And, we were like, I don't know if we have enough stuff. Like, I don't know if it's worth hauling it all down there, staying all day, and then hauling it all back. It's, you know, it's a lot of work. Mm-hmm. But it was 100% the best move we could have made because mm-hmm. it got our name out there. We got to know people. People got to know us,
yep.
mm-hmm. who then became our members.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
And it probably the best marketing you could do in the beginning.
Yeah. And the staff has always been helpful, 100% on board. They're like, as many local farms as we can get is great. For produce as long as you can, that's great. You know, yeah. So they've always been really, really excited to have us, and that's been amazing. And, yeah, the booth fee's never an issue. You always get your money back. Yeah, no big deal. And, again, it's that thing that's like it makes it cohesive. We're all, like, helping each other. We're supporting the thing we believe in, you know. So we show up. Yeah. We do our part. If the booth fee goes up, whatever, that's fine. Yeah, you guys work hard too. So, yeah, it's always been amazing. But yeah, so I guess that would put us at 5 years at the market.
Nice.
5 years.
Yeah. Real good.
Going on 6 this year, I guess.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
Been for a bit.
Yeah.
Yeah, it's been really good.
It's amazing, yeah. I don't know what else to say about it other than it's just really great. Like,
the connection with all of the other business owners is really cool too because we met other people we collaborate with.
Mm-hmm.
So in an effort to try to like make it easier for our customers to have access to like multiple things, not just produce,
mm-hmm.
we are offering like Windy River meat membership,
mm-hmm.
Chorizo from Don Felipe,
yep.
you know, like I really like being able to kind of cultivate like multiple things in one box because it's A, it's easier for the person, and B, it like helps everybody out.
Agreed.
So, yeah, that's been pretty cool. Just like collaborating with other businesses.
Mm-hmm.
A lot of the restaurants we met were through. Like I think we met you at the farmers market mm-hmm. originally.
I believe so.
And then
a lot of people we've met through the market
like last year. I guess a little bit over a year ago, my buddy Isaiah Bryant started a hot sauce company at Elevated, and he met me at the farmer's market, and I had some Reapers in a box behind the mm-hmm. table because of a incident with a small child the previous year who they weren't decorative, and he
really?
Decided, you know, one should be played like a drum, and I was like, all right, this can't go on the table anymore. But he just peeks over and he's like, are those super hots back there? It's like, yeah. And like we hit it off and like now we're like friends and he buys peppers from me. You know?
Nice.
But it's like I'm happy to have the friend, but it's really cool to have like a friend and a customer. Like,
you guys work with Salaji sauce too?
Mm-hmm. We do. Yeah. Oh, yeah. So yeah, Dave bought a 50 pounds of super hots from us last year, which was so cool. We got a nice
sauce.
Oh yeah.
That's a lot of sauce.
Yeah. They're pumping it out.
Yeah.
But yeah, it was really cool to get a picture with him, and it's like his carts just stacks and crates of bright pods. And so that was really, really cool. And yeah, we've been working with them for probably 6 years.
Yeah.
Because I think our first year growing peppers, like he bought some stuff. We didn't grow much of anything, but he still was like, oh, yeah.
Right on.
Came out, saw the farm. Yeah.
So,
yeah, they're good dudes.
Pretty cool.
Nice.
Yeah. And I know his twin boys from climbing, so Mitchell and
Ryan. Right on.
Yeah. Yeah. So we've been friends for a while. And it's,
cool.
Yeah,
they're good dudes.
Yeah, like they're super good dudes. Yeah.
Definitely.
Right on. All right, let's dive into the peppers then.
All right.
Yeah. Let's segue.
Yeah. Yeah, the one that hurt my brain still is, I guess, some seven-pot something or other.
Oh, yeah, the seven-pot Cardee. And Cardee is an acronym. It stands for the Caribbean Agricultural Research and Development Institute. So it's a...
What the fuck did you give me?
Yeah.
it's experimental science.
Right, yeah. So it's actually like a really old strain of Caribbean. Like, it would be the predecessor to the Trinidad scorpion. So
aha.
or the Maruga scorpion. So it's same genetics and all of that, but it was a pepper that's been like collected by people who live in the Caribbean and shared, like usually amongst females. They do most of the gardening and cooking. And so this is like one of these like beloved peppers. And the seven pot part of seven pot peppers means you can take one pod and dip it in and season seven pots of stew.
Oh, no shit.
Yeah, so that's how hot they are. They're like, yeah, they're searingly hot. Yeah.
My mouth is getting sweaty just thinking about it.
You're right, yeah.
It was aggressive. I mean, it's like that Homer Simpson one when he ate that. It was psychedelic.
Yeah, psychedelic experience.
That same year you had it, I ate half of one of those, and that was a bad idea. I was like doubled over, and I didn't get sick, but I thought I was going to get sick. And yeah, definitely you feel like you're trapped, like in a psychedelic trip that maybe you didn't plan on taking.
It was aggressive.
Yeah.
And that's when we were down doing pizzas down there, and I got a coffee from Coffee X on the corner. Mm-hmm. So I was caffeinated, and then I had that fucking mime blaster. I remember it was a slow day, and I was just sitting there like, I might die. Yeah. I feel really alive at the same time. Yeah. And it was like that. Oh, man, it was.
Did you eat the whole thing?
Oh, fuck yeah. Oh, fuck around. Just, boom, just go for it. Yeah.
I got to give you a round of applause. That's That's incredible.
When I was
I have eaten pieces, very small pieces.
But. Yeah, I mean, we'll go for it. When I was in San Francisco,
wow.
We would do Sunday, I think it was Saturday, something, whatever. We'd do brunch, but most of the crew was, Mexican. Mm-hmm. And every once in a while, somebody would come in, a little fucking borracho. So it was a raw egg, some orange juice, and a jalapeno.
Yeah.
And I was like, yeah, we're going to get going.
Yeah. That's your breakfast.
Exactly. Nice. And it was like a jalapeno, we got delivered or something like that.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
So, other restaurants was like, hey, I'll just have a jalapeno here. And one time, ghost peppers were getting it. So we all gathered around. People ate pieces of it. Some people ate the whole one. There's a picture of people puking in the garbage. Yeah. Here's somebody's head just covered in sweat. Yeah. So like the pepper thing, it's like, yeah, we get some hot ones and I'll just eat them.
Oh, yeah.
So, when you gave me them, I'm just going to eat it all.
Yeah.
And it was
nice. Life-changing experience.
Yeah. Oh, yeah.
Memorable.
Yeah. Oh, yeah. And she's given me flack before about, you're not a good barometer. Like, you have a high spice tolerance. And I was like, yeah. I try to always warn people. These are really hot. Like, if you can't eat a habanero, don't even mess with it. Like, that's your starting ground, But
that's a starting ground.
Yeah.
A habanero?
Yeah.
Yeah.
Like, some other one, like a Thai chili or a jalapeno.
Yeah, I was going to say.
Habanero.
Serrano is pretty hot. Oh, yeah. Yeah, you better not touch those.
Yeah, which is nice. Like, there are widely known pepper varieties that you can kind of give people reference for if they're at the market and they're like, because they are beautiful, and so people will see them on the table and say, oh, that does look amazing, they don't even look real, like, what are they? And I'll tell them, are they hot? You're like, oh yeah, really, really hot. Yeah. And so I tried to start arranging the table different this last year, so all the hots are like kind of up
nice
and in the corner, and then everything else is like, oops, is like out there for you. Yeah, if you like sweets or milds, yeah, they're all out there. But it's a passion thing. I really love growing them. They're cool, and they're open pollinated, so we seed save, and every year you get like really neat crosses. Like, we have a UFO scotch bonnet now that has purple shouldering, and so the plants are beautiful, and they make these really pretty, funky looking pods, but they're really fruity and awesome. Good nice. Back of the mouth burn. Yeah.
I'm intrigued.
Yeah. Damn. Yeah, but we do tons of stuff with peppers. We make hot sauce. We also sell to hot sauce makers. Mm-hmm. We dry them. We make powders. In fact, the only time I've ever been called by Jordan was because you bought one of my super hot chili salts. And you used it to finish your pies at the market one day.
Mm-hmm.
And I guess a woman, even though you had warned her as well, thought she had an allergic reaction. Mm-hmm. And he called me and he was like, I just have to check, even though I know the answer. He's like, is there anything else in this besides chilies and salt? And I was like, nope, that's it. He's like, okay. He's like, I just have to call this woman back and explain that it's two simple ingredients. If you're not allergic to either of those, I don't know what to tell you. Yeah.
Enjoy the trip.
Yeah. Yeah, exactly. Yeah. You will live. You'll be fine.
Exactly.
It doesn't last forever.
It's like the people calling 911. Are they saying prop brownie? I think I'm dying. Yeah. Oh, you're going to be fine.
Right. Yeah.
Just greening out. It's okay.
Yeah. Yeah.
You'll live.
Beautiful. Right on. So value added stuff. I mean, it's something I like to talk about with farmers because you can get grants for it. Mm. You can add value to things, bring in more revenue. Your foodies, you can cook, you can make stuff.
Mm-hmm.
What do you guys do or hope to do with value-added stuff?
I would say, like, right now, like, probably it might seem weird, but we're still kind of trying to find our niche. I love making hot sauce, but it's a pretty saturated market, so I'm happy to make it as a seasonal item, and, like, when it's out, it's out. That's cool. It makes it good, you know, and every year it's – I kind of have, like, I have some architecture for the recipes I like to use, but they shift a little bit. Like, so I make a mole-inspired one, and if I can't get cherries, I'll use a different sweet fruit to, like, use the sweeten it on the back end to cut all that heat. But, yeah, I would say, like, I like doing that, but, yeah, we're probably leaning more towards, like, seasonings, I would say, like, because dry products are easier to handle, there's less licensing involved and all of that, and it's also less, on our end, for two busy people, it's less laborious. You just, like,
set it, forget it.
Yeah, you just wash it, throw it dryer, done. Mm-hmm. Yeah.
You guys got a dehydrator?
Yeah, we got a couple. Yeah, a couple. Yeah, and then, and I'll let Kelly take it from here, because she has some things. She's hitting some home runs.
So, you know, his fave is peppers. Mm-hmm. Mine's probably got to be garlic, mm-hmm. I would say. Yeah, I love garlic. So I delved into making black garlic last year. Was it last year? I think it was maybe the year before.
Yeah, almost 2 years. Yeah.
2 years?
2 years, yeah.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, and I'm just obsessed with it. I'm trying to get everybody on it because not only is it amazing, it tastes great, but it's really good for you.
Super good for you.
So good for you.
There's a reason it's been around for 1,000 years.
Exactly. Yeah. So, and a lot of people think it just grows that way, and I'm like, no, it's actually this really cool process. Mm-hmm. The Maillard reaction.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
It's like caramelizing your onion, so, but garlic. And
very slow.
Yeah. Super low.
Slow, yeah.
Low and slow.
High humidity. Yeah. Yeah.
Yeah, but that's definitely been one of the main things I've been trying to promote a little bit, get it out there. That's one of the main things we sell to Rubinette Produce in Portland.
Right on.
We got black garlic there. I make a lot of sauces, too. Mm. So I'm hoping once we, you know, get that value added going a little stronger, mm-hmm. we'll be able to provide people with, like, here's an easy stir-fry sauce. You just throw it in your veggies, and you got dinner. Really quick, mm-hmm. simple. Pesto. Fermented stuff. We'll ferment garlic scapes.
Yeah.
Nice.
Sambal. And,
I've been doing like a mm-hmm. garlic kraut. So you just take the fermented garlic scape, mm-hmm. all naturally fermented, just sea salt and water, mm-hmm. and then chop it up. And it's mm-hmm. like a sauerkraut, mm-hmm. but with a little more texture.
Yeah.
And that's been really good. And it tastes like garlic. It's so good. Mm-hmm. So doing that. We met one of our friends, Tubetin, who used to run Buckman Brines. He was doing all naturally fermented products and would buy cucumbers and other things from us. Mm-hmm. And we just met and started chatting about it. And essentially, we're kind of like working with him to try to ferment our own products and learning from him. And mm-hmm. it's been a cool journey.
Nice.
Yeah.
Sandor Katz, his book. You familiar with that? Mm-mm. Can you pull him up, please, Charlie?
Is that the art of fermentation?
No. I believe so, yeah.
Maybe? Mm-hmm. Yeah.
I mean, he's like the godfather in America right now about it. There's some other cool ones. Kristen Shockey on the Instagram. She does some really cool fermenting stuff. Sander Katz, is that him? Yeah, that's his book.
Oh, nice, I actually have not read it. I know of it.
I haven't read it either.
Yeah.
I really, you know, as I get more into my cooking journey, it's a lot of, I know it's vegetables, they're clean, stuff's sterile for the fucking most part.
Yeah.
Sterile.
Yeah.
2% salt.
Whew. Yeah.
Mush, bleeds out a little bit, jam it in a jar, burp it every once in a while.
Yeah.
It's going to come out or it's not.
Yeah.
You know? I really don't even, that's how I bake and stuff like that too. Yeah. It's like, oh, I was going to put it. I know these three ingredients are going to have this result. I'll do it this way this time. It may have a different result next time.
Oh, for sure. Yeah. And I like fermented things for sure. Like I've brewed my own beer for a long time and we've been making sauerkraut or
kimchi.
We help with the chopping and all that. Nice. But some things don't ferment well. I'm just going to say
that's true.
Yeah, some things are weird when they're fermented.
Yeah.
So, and that's kind of fun to figure out, too. You're like, oh, wow.
That does not taste great.
Yeah. I mean, some things, you know, they'll be terrible when you taste them. And if they wait 6 months, they'll be great, too.
Yeah.
That's true.
You know, like,
that's true.
Well, what's the original, like, fucking exos or fish sauce? Garam masala, like the Romans, you know, it's a bunch of fish in a jar. You come and taste that, and it's going to be fucking terrible. But in a year, it's like, that's pretty fucking
that
delicious.
Right? Yeah. Be amazing. Yeah, exactly. And adds all that, like, flavoring umami to your dish.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
that you can't really, it's hard to get otherwise.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. I love, it's one of my favorite things about doing, you know, stuff in a jar and tasting it at the stages. You know, yeah. It's like, oh, it's pissing out the top a little bit. Let's crack it. I take a little bit. It's like, oh.
Yeah.
So aggressive, eyes watering. Yeah. And then in a month, it's like,
yeah. Oh, yeah.
Perfect.
You hit that.
And then it changes. Oh, it's like, okay, I'll refrigerate it now. And another month, you know, hasn't stopped. It's just slower. And now it's different even more.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
That's fucking.
It's pretty cool.
That's food.
Yeah.
That's how food is. Yeah. Food should be enjoyed.
So it's kind of like the food has its second life, you know. It's grown, and now it's like you've slowed its rate of decomposition so much that it's like it's just really slow and going to catch it right when you want it. Yeah.
And that's all cooking is from my, you know, you get a raw piece of beef and put it on heat.
Mm-hmm.
It's breaking down. You're breaking it down, but you're controlling it. It's controlled decomposition on all the levels.
Mm-hmm.
You know, I'm going to season a salad with salt. That salt is going to react.
Yeah.
But by the time I do it till it gets to your table, you know,
it's going to be a different breaking, thing.
Exactly. Mm-hmm. You know?
Yeah.
Any kind of acid you put on it as well. I think it's mostly all we do as cooks in general is control the decomposition of it. Or as a baker or a brewer, you know, you're controlling fermentation.
Yeah.
Time and temperature.
Yeah,
light too, hopefully, you know.
Mm-hmm. But, yeah, you're trying to isolate and elevate like certain flavors, like through preservation, whether it's beer or baking. Like and again, it's like it's that thing. If it's a good version, will not last forever. You know, it will it will eventually age out or become like so thin, like so devoid of what it had to start with that it just, you know, you're like, well, that's as far as I could slow it. That's as long as it could live. Yeah.
Exactly.
But it is really cool. It is like a really fun act of alchemy to be like, I wonder if I can do that. Mm-hmm. You know, and fermentation's fun in that way because it's harder. It's way more unpredictable. Mm-hmm. You know, like you can't add a cup of that flavor. It's either you get it or you don't.
Yeah. Right. Jars are exploding.
We did that one wrong.
Not that next time.
Yeah.
Blowing the top off containers.
Yeah.
A few of those. Yeah,
I've
for sure.
Yeah, I've had some beers like that. Yeah.
A kombucha journey that ended up with a...
Oh, yeah. I made Saison last year and came downstairs and there's foam everywhere, like just all over the super lively Belgian farmhouse beer and just... It was
sounds delicious though.
Yeah. It was good. It was alive enough that nothing got in. You know, like everything was going out. So was,
right on.
Yeah, it was good. But it is fun. Every once in a while, you get a bomb. Yeah.
Why are you putting on that suit and those goggles to go in the fridge? Yeah. You'll find out. Glass grenade goes off.
Right.
Yeah, man. Yeah. Beautiful. Mm-hmm. Strange question, perhaps, but you know, people ask me like, you know, what's your favorite pizza? What's your favorite thing that you grow? You know, peppers was a thing, but, you know, what else that you really like?
I think, like, some of the newer stuff that I didn't really know existed before I became a farmer, kohlrabi, which is totally random. Cucamelons.
Oh, yeah. Those
are any fruit is always great.
Nice.
Yeah, any of the fruit is always really yummy. I really like growing potatoes.
You guys post a lot of
which
potatoes.
Which is really weird. Yeah. Potatoes?
I was going to say potatoes.
Potatoes, yeah. Well, so I had no idea that they had a different flavor. Every potato we grow tastes different.
Oh, yeah.
And they, you know, when you're out there, we dig them by hand. So it's literally like you're in the soil and you're digging for gold. It's actually really fun.
Mm-hmm.
It does get old after a little bit, but it's fun. And we do it with our community. Like, we invite people to come out and dig potatoes with us. So it's kind of like a farm event. And it's really cool. People, you know, kids get to come out and they're like, oh, look at this little potato I found. It looks like Mickey Mouse or whatever.
Yeah.
So it's, yeah, it's pretty fun. And the flavors are amazing. Like, there's a few varieties we grow that I, like, had no idea potatoes could be so good.
Yeah. Which ones?
Nicola is one of my favorites. Mm-hmm. So the funny thing about Nicola, it's a yellow, just a standard yellow potato, but it's tastes sweeter than a regular potato. However, the glycemic index is actually lower. So that perceptible sweetness, it's really good. Like, people that have diabetes or some other issue where they can't have as much sugar can still eat it.
Nice.
And then another one that I love personally is the Purple Viking.
Okay.
So that one is, it's like a galaxy in a potato. It's purple and pink, like galaxy. And then the inside is white, but the flavor is just phenomenal. It's, I don't even know how to describe it. It's still sweet,
really
but
good,
it just has like a clean, really nice flavor.
Right on.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
Yeah, let's see. Okay, so besides...
Carrots are always good.
Oh, yeah, carrots are great. Besides peppers, I mean, like, you can't live on peppers alone. So I would say I love growing tomatoes, that's even if it's cliche. Yeah. But tomatoes, yeah, like perennials. So plums, we got a ton of green gauge plums last year. Nice. And those were killer. They were so good. The Asian pears that come off the tree are just, like, outstanding. I can't wait till they're older and we can share these, like, incredible pears with people. And melons.
The melons.
Oh, man, nothing melons like melons.
Earlier. Yeah. I mean, it's a 100-degree day and you get a warm melon right there and so juice dripping off the face.
Oh, yeah.
Ooh, my mouth got sweaty again.
Yeah, getting the saliva.
Yeah, it's super good. Going.
Cucumbers. There's a couple of varieties I discovered. One of them I really love. It's called the Painted Serpent. Oh. So it's an Asian-style cucumber, long, and it does, like, sometimes it'll do some crazy shapes. Mm-hmm. But it's actually, like, striped light green, dark green, and it has a little bit of, like, a hairiness.
Okay.
So it's, like, soft fuzz. Mm-hmm. It's almost like a peach, but it's a cucumber, and that has awesome flavor. When we discovered that one, I was like, oh, yeah, I'm definitely going to grow this every year.
Nice. Oh, yeah, Laramie loves to use those guys.
Yeah. It's almost like a cross between an Armenian cucumber and, like, an Asian long cucumber.
Nice.
Mm-hmm. That one's got awesome flavor.
At Son of Man, they'll have, like, a event and whatnot. They have this huge fodor. I forgot how to say it. It's like a huge barrel.
Oh, the fooder? Nice.
Yeah. How do you say it?
Fooder.
Fooder. Yeah. Yeah, exactly. But... at the festivals and whatnot, you get your glass, you're 10 feet away, they turn it on, it comes shooting out of there, you catch it in your glass.
That's awesome.
That would be so cool to see.
Yeah.
Nice.
But yeah, there's...
that takes some planning.
Yeah.
That's cool.
There's some process for it, and, you know, makes it taste better, you know, aerates a little bit, just like doing that with wine and stuff like that.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah. But
get your Venturi with the wine.
Yeah.
Have you seen those?
Nice.
That's pretty cool.
I've been... I did a little bit of research on ciders back in the day. My homie... had a homie that... Are we back on? All right, we're back on. It'll be a little discontinuity, but anyway. Yeah. My homie had a homie who... I think she still makes... Can you pull up... what is it called? Autumn Cider? No. Eve's Cider. Her name's Autumn. Autumn Stochek. Eve's Cider. Out of Ithaca, New York. Is that Ithaca? Eve Cidery. Yeah, that sounds about right.
Okay. Nice.
But she sells to a bunch of famous restaurants in the city and all over the place now. But they were friends, and he was like, hey, we need somebody to sell cider at one of the markets in New York.
Mm-hmm.
And he was like, you're not doing anything, let's go up there. And I was like, oh, I don't know nothing about no cider. So I did a bunch of reading on it, and the food that they make with the cider, and they'll just take like Cabrales blue cheese and fresh cider and mix it together. I was like, how fucking good can that be? It's like two really strong flavors. Oh, it's just fucking delicious.
Great. Yeah.
Everything. Right. But there's whole like festivals around it and everything.
That's awesome.
Yeah, man. Does it say who they sell to? People and places, pair and serve, buy and serve, visit and taste.
People and place?
Yeah.
Maybe.
Autumn was the girl's name. I don't know if she's still familiar with it. I don't know. This is many moons ago.
That's awesome.
Yeah, blue cheese. There it is.
Blue cheese. There's the blue cheese.
Yeah, yeah, you're right.
Thing right there. Yeah, Ithaca Farmers Market.
So funny. I could see that working out, though.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Definitely.
So you get the creaminess and the funk, and then you get the... There's a little bit of funk in the cider, too.
Mm-hmm.
Complement it. Totally.
Yeah.
Hmm.
Yeah, it's pretty amazing. Like, I feel like a lot of... wow. Like... quintessential European cuisine is all about like just good ingredients, which is like what we've been talking about most of the time.
Buy good food and you have to do a whole lot to it.
Oh yeah, like good Italian food's like a handful of ingredients. It's just it's ready when you get it, you know. Yeah.
Autumn Stochek, I forget what her name was. Yeah, but me and Keith went there to sell her product, and you know, we had a small vehicle and just cases of wine, and you know, a bunch of years later she's selling to, you know, Gramercy Tavern, like all Michelin star restaurants and shit like that.
That's awesome.
You know, listen to her just talk about, you know, a cool person creating cool shit, being really passionate about their project. You know, she's out there fucking, yeah, look at all this fucking shit.
Wow.
Yeah, banana. Yeah. I mean, it's bananas, great cider.
Yeah.
You know, they're talking about fracking in there. She's out there just fucking railing against those people to fucking grow vegetables here and shit like that.
Right.
And then going, you know, people talking about cider. It's like, you make shit cider. you don't even use cider apples. And I was like, well, all apples are cider apples. And she's like, I don't.
No. As a grower, you're like, no, blasphemy.
That's
total
blasphemy.
Believe me, if we tried to market you cider apples as eating apples, you would know.
Yeah.
Very quickly.
You know the difference, for sure.
Oh, yeah. Super astringent. Yeah.
I went to visit my homie in Ithaca one time, and he was like, hey, you know, Autumn's doing, they're blending all their ciders right now. Ooh. She's like, you want to go up? I'm like,
that'd be cool.
Abso-fucking-lutely.
Yeah.
We're just sitting at their kitchen table, and there's like little pipettes of anything. Like, I don't know shit, but I was like, this one's a little buttery. I think that's like a defect or something like that. And they were like, rrr, rrr. I was like, yeah. Like, I mean, it was like it got infected.
Oh, you even caught it.
Yeah.
Yeah.
But they're just sitting there blending. And I was like, yeah, this is the one. I was like, yeah, that's fucking the one, man. It was super cool to see the whole process.
That's really cool.
Now they're just like
amazing.
All the press and everything. Yeah. But yeah, so not all apples are, you know, there's heirloom apples and they're not all for eating. You know, there's best for juices and things.
For sure.
Yeah. Well, and apples, because they readily like cross-pollinate, you'll never get one from seed that is the same as the parent. So there's like millions, endless possibilities of apples out there.
Beautiful. Yeah.
It's crazy.
Yeah, that's pretty cool.
I could dig it.
We did in New Zealand, we worked on a few apple projects. Like part of our ag work there, we worked at a big orchard that would sell apples all over the world. And then I worked for a nursery and propagated like thousands of apple rootstocks.
Oh, wow.
Like, they're really big in apples in New Zealand.
Yeah, they are.
Yeah. They were selling like these huge, Sonia, right, was the name of this like gigantic apple that they grew to Japan. And it's like one apple is $3.
Mm-hmm.
It's like,
okay,
dang.
Yeah, they were huge.
They were a pound.
Yeah, they kind of look like an upside down pear, I guess, but they were huge. Yeah, they were like, I have a good sized hand, and they were like the size of my outstretched hand. They were huge, and I guess they were given as gifts in Japan. So like when you go visit somebody,
it's
you bring it.
Here.
And I was like, that's cool.
I love all that stuff in the culture. Yeah. I know it's when Matsutake's come around. It might be a new seed. It's like getting a perfect specimen and putting it in a box. And it's like, I love you. Here's a mushroom. Fucking best gift ever.
Oh, yeah.
I'm going to eat it. I'm going to slice it on pasta. But
Paul from Razo's gave us some Matsutake's in the fall. And I had never had them before. Yeah. I didn't even realize. I was like, this is an incredible mushroom. Yeah. I mean, this sucker was like big. I was like, damn.
Beautiful.
It's cool.
Yeah, they're really sweet people. Like they, every time he goes out foraging, Paul and Lindsay, they're just like, hey, we got some extras. You want some? We're like, okay, yeah.
Absolutely.
We're just like, you want eggs? What do you want? And they usually just give it to you. Yeah.
It's a hard toss-up between my favorite mushroom. I mean, porcinis are really hard to go. Go against, but Matsutake's are right up there. When you get a good one, it's like, we can smell it from over there, and it's like...
Oh, yeah.
And the flavor's incredible.
It's a tough sell. Like when they're in season, you know, we get the whatever mushroom is salut, whatever mushroom, you know, the mushroom guy picks.
Right.
So when they're in season, those are the ones that go on the pizza. And some people are like, these aren't mushroomy enough, or they're too mushroomy.
Yeah.
It's like, do you realize what the fuck you're eating?
Right? Yeah, this is amazing. They're just so disconnected.
Yes.
I mean, that's part of food is like, you're almost, and of a farmer, is like, you're an educator.
Oh, you have
people
to.
People have no idea sometimes, and it's cool to be able to like explain it.
Mm-hmm. That's a big part of taking it to market, too. Like, you're there selling your stuff. That's a part of having employees, too.
Yeah.
It's like they're representing your product. You know, you have to give them enough information and knowledge so they can not necessarily sell it, but inform the customer.
For sure. Right. Yeah,
that's what builds a relationship.
Mm-hmm.
You know, somebody comes to you and only buys tomatoes. And it's like, hey, we've got these really cool peppers now.
Yeah.
You really like our tomatoes? Try this. And next thing you know, you've got a pepper buyer, too.
Yeah. You know? For sure. And it's like... every season that we're there, I think we get more and more regulars because they go, you're the farmer? I'm like, yeah, I'm the farmer. I'm like, oh, okay, I'll come back next week.
Yeah.
And
well, thank you. You know, and I'll see them every week after that I work the market, you know, and I'm sure they're there when Kelly's there too. Yeah. And it's like really, really cool. They're like, oh, well, I want to buy my food from I want to be able to meet the person that grew this or helped grow it. Yeah. And so, that's our goal, is to always have the market stand like manned by a person who works on the farm.
Yeah.
Cause that firsthand knowledge is pretty indispensable, and they'll know what it tastes like and have all kinds of fun little information about it.
Absolutely.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. Invested in it.
Mm-hmm.
Ownership. That's great. Something we touched on earlier, that I was thinking about a couple of days before, but I'm going to explore it a little bit. Organic.
Mm-hmm.
You guys said you're not, certified organic.
Mm-hmm.
That's fine, but you follow all the practices and principles of that.
Yeah.
Right.
What does that mean to you? What does that look like for you?
So organic essentially is like you're not using any crazy chemicals. Everything is right. natural. Mm-hmm. We've been more than organic since we started. But the actual like process of organic, I guess, certification, mm-hmm. it's a lot of paperwork.
Yep.
A lot of paperwork. You have to have records of every single thing you're putting into the soil, how much you're harvesting, how much you're selling, how much is wasted, varieties, where you got your seeds from, mm-hmm. are your seeds organic? You know, I mean, it's like, it's crazy amounts of tracking and paperwork, which a lot of it we do anyway. Last year it was, some of that went out the window.
Yeah.
We were really busy, and then I was trying to figure out the whole property thing with the new property and getting that settled. So it was a little bit of a crazy year, but yeah. The certification itself, it's more, I mean, what is it, like 80 pages? And then you have to provide crop plans, you have to provide all of your records, you have an inspector come out and check mm-hmm. it out.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, you have like buffer zones and all that. There's other crops grown yeah. there, yeah.
And then if there's other farmers, like, I think one of the other things was like, you can't, if you're sharing space with someone who's not organic, you have to have a space separation, like in the cooler even.
Hmm.
So it's like, it's a lot. There's a lot yeah. to it.
Mm-hmm.
But the thing with organic, especially on a large scale, is like, sure, you can do all that, but if you're not actually like rebuilding your soil, it doesn't mean much.
Yeah.
Essentially, you're still like taking too much out, and mm-hmm. eventually the soil will just be useless.
Yeah.
And I think that's like a pretty huge topic that in the last few years has kind of come to light, is like with a lot of the agriculture and tillage and like what we're doing, taking so much out of the soil, eventually we're going to become, it's going to be desertification again and the Dust Bowl. And that's going to be within our lifetime.
Hmm.
It's pretty scary, actually. Like, I don't know, Vananda Shiva? There's been some really cool podcasts. And
Vandana Shiva is her
Vandana.
Name.
Vandana
yeah.
Shiva
yeah,
has some really interesting talks about it.
Yeah.
Could just
you pull
like,
it up, please?
Yeah.
Vandana Shiva?
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Yeah, so she's like
check to you on spelling.
She has like a scientific background in physics, but she's mm-hmm. like a food advocate in India.
Would you hit it right off the yeah. bat? Look at you, guy.
Yeah.
Fanatic.
But yeah, I would say like on our farm, like we strive to do regenerative agriculture, for lack of a better term. So we do a lot of soil building. Like mm-hmm. we add compost. We are trying to get better at cover cropping, but we
we're so small scale
yeah.
that it's hard to slot it in and get it growing
yeah. mm-hmm.
and have that empty space.
But we like yeah. tractor our chickens through, so we have an element of animal husbandry where we're using like manure, and you do, no matter what kind of farming you have to have minimum days to harvest between chickens and food
mm-hmm.
cropping. Mm-hmm. And that's really easy to do. We just move them through in the winter, and
yeah.
then come this month they're not allowed in there anymore, you know.
Right. Mm-hmm. And I think a lot of
anti-consumerism. Nice.
Yeah.
That's awesome, nope. yeah. I mean, part of the process that we are trying to do is, like, closing. So I guess on a permaculture, which is, like, permanent agriculture
mm-hmm.
Kind of scale, like, you're trying to make it holistic. You're trying to close, like, continue the circle. So what you're producing goes back to the land. You're trying to provide your own fertilizer, your own seeds. Like, the holistic part of it is, like, you're looking at not just like, we're not just growing food. We're trying to make happy animals that are refertilizing the soil. Like the chickens, when we incorporated that a few years ago, has been pretty big.
Mm-hmm.
Any waste we have, food waste, since we've had animals, it doesn't go into a compost pile, but it goes to the animals, it feeds them, and then they feed the soil. Mm-hmm. So composting on a small scale can be a little bit tough. Well, on our scale, we're not small, but we're not big. So it's like hand turning, and so mm-hmm. it's a lot of work, but
mm-hmm.
just trying to close the gaps, create more of your own resources so that you're not outsourcing everything.
Mm-hmm.
And
yeah.
So no spray at all for you guys?
Only food, really. Like, yeah. So like fish emulsion, like just like fermented fish
guts and mm-hmm. whatever comes out of that industry. Kelp meal. Kelp, yeah. Various nutrients like we use.
For spray or for?
For
like foliar feeding.
Yeah, so those are all foliar plant. Feeding. You can also do compost tea, which is something I look to do okay. more this year. But and that works more on like a microbe level. It's a living food, whereas mm-hmm. like the fish derivatives and the sea derivatives mm-hmm. have great nutrient in them.
Just like the nitrogen.
Yeah, but it's not. It wouldn't have like live microbes or anything. Mm-hmm. Yeah. It's all been pasteurized.
No pepper spray or anything like that for insects?
No, we haven't done pepper spray. We don't have good respirators, I would say, that would hold up to that.
I mean, if we wanted to go that route.
Proper fuck if you got the wind going the wrong way.
Yeah.
I mean, I've literally maced myself just mixing up chili salt. Yeah. And it's like, strong stuff.
Mm-hmm. For sure.
But it would definitely kill some aphids. Mm-hmm. I haven't actually delved into that yet, but it's been something that's been on my mind.
But we do companion plants, so we try to plants together that either one plant will ward off insects or it's mm-hmm. sometimes can be called a trap or sacrificial crop. So like nasturtiums are a flower that almost everyone's familiar with. Mm-hmm. They kind of cascade and have these lily pad leaves.
Grow everywhere around here.
Yeah, they go nuts. Delicious. Really, really
watercress
good.
Family, right?
Yeah. Mm-hmm. But bugs love them. So you can plant those on the ends of your rows or your garden boxes and the bugs will eat that and they'll leave most of your things alone. I mean, mm-hmm. a bug-free garden isn't anything you would want and it's not something you can achieve.
Right.
Yeah. And so,
you just kind of plan on like 10% crop loss or whatever, mm-hmm. whatever percentage.
Yeah, you overplant.
They get to eat too, right?
Yeah.
It may be annoying, but you know, eat everybody.
Yeah. Some crops and I guess that's another thing we do on our farm is it's polycultural. We plant many, many, many things. We grow probably 50 plus different things in a season. And so not everything succeeds. Some things fail miserably. Some things are very low yielding. And the way to ensure against that is just to grow a lot of different stuff. Mm-hmm. And so, you know, it's because we do the market, it is amazing. Say the radishes don't turn out, but we end up with bok choy and garlic scapes and just tons of it. Mm-hmm. So we go to the market, we can offload that, and then what we can't sell, we give to the food bank. Yeah, and they buy up to a certain amount each year at a reduced rate, but that's really great too because you don't want to just...
No backhauling.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Yep.
That was something we explored in conversation with Jordan.
Mm, yeah.
He said they're still working on that to do more of that too.
Nice. Yeah, it's link good. The food bank with the market.
Yeah.
Oh, yeah. Mm-hmm. That'd be cool. Yeah, because we do have to make a separate trip, which is not a big deal. Mm-hmm. But it would be cool if they had someone come down. And.
But every Sunday, they usually do have someone picking up produce. Mm-hmm. Yeah, cool. So this year, it'll be easier.
Oh, right. Yeah, because we only did Saturdays. So I'm like,
we were always there only on Saturdays, and so we'd have to make a separate trip to the food bank. But yeah, definitely, like, food equity is, like, a huge part of why we farm also. Mm-hmm. I mean, I started growing my own food because I literally couldn't afford. And once I learned about like how many horrible things are being sprayed on standard produce, like commercially grown, you know, I was like, oh, wow, okay, I have to buy organic now. But then going to the store, I'm like, damn, I can't afford that. So I started growing my own food and, you know, like just trying to spread that love. Like we have a scholarship program where people can donate to help sponsor the cost of someone else's share. Mm-hmm. We take... SNAP, EBT, all of that. We work both Oregon and Washington. And I think the farmers market, you probably talked about it, they part of their cost sharing program is they'll actually cover like half of the cost mm-hmm. of someone's share per week, mm-hmm. which is pretty awesome with grant funding and great. Other things. We're always welcome to like have people come out and work for produce because mm-hmm. Lord knows, it takes a village. We need many hands make light work.
Well, yeah.
And so, you know, any volunteers we get, we'll give produce to. And mm-hmm. yeah, I don't know, just trying to make it equitable for everybody, which can be, you know, a challenge.
Oh, for sure.
Especially with inflation right now, it's mm-hmm. hard to get good food.
Agreed.
But
yeah, and the reality of supporting local things is they do cost more money. And that's not a bad thing. It's just part of what it is. It might mean, like, for us, like, we don't go out to eat as often, but we're typically more choosy about where we go.
Right. Excellent. You
know, yeah.
As well, you should be.
Yeah, right? Yeah. And so, like, I think with the vegetables, it's amazing the market does that because we know our prices aren't attainable for everybody. Mm-hmm. But with them matching it, it makes it like a lot easier for people to get, anyone interested to get good produce. They can afford it. It's still cheaper than the store, you know, with the market helping out. And so it's like.
And you know it's going to be way better.
Oh, yeah.
Absolutely.
Yeah.
Nothing against large-scale growers at all. I mean, everyone's just trying to make ends meet. But being able to have that connection with the farmer, I think, has made a huge difference with people. And that, like I was saying before, like the educational aspect of it is huge. But, you know, really, I think for me especially, I was, you know, I grew up with, like, we're trying to be cheap. We're trying to, like, get things at the cheapest price possible. Mm-hmm. And, like, the learning curve for me was, like, but you got to look into how it was grown and what else are you supporting with that. So I think it's been kind of a learning curve, be like, most of the commercial produce, like, A, farmers are paid pennies on the dollar versus what they should be getting paid, and it's going through a third person, like it's going through grocery stores. So their workers are not being paid living wages. They're probably not even being paid minimum wage. You know, there's a lot of that going on in large scale food system. And so we're, you know, we strive to pay our workers a living wage. It's getting harder and harder in the Northwest.
Yeah.
But, you know, it's definitely really important to us to be able to pay someone for the work it takes. And ourselves, hopefully,
and
someday.
Too,
hopefully, someday.
Yeah. I'm going to transition
we'll
down
get to that point.
You pay yourselves.
We make a little less than our employees, but that's all right. for the time being, we do have an advantageous situation, which allows us to figure this stuff out. So that's really nice. But yeah, it can be a struggle. Like, yeah, money's just a tricky subject in general. It's kind of a tough thing to navigate. Wages have gone up really quick. But yeah, we always start people above minimum wage is our goal, and which we've never failed at so far. And then they also get vegetables and eggs and free attendance to any dinner or event we might do at the farm. Yeah. So it's, you know, and then I think in our farmhand from last year's returning, Janae, and some people might know her from the market. She was working for Mindful Mushrooms for a while.
Right on.
And I remember last year we were like discussing all the like fringe benefits, and she's like, "Lynn, you gotta like who you work with." And I was like, "Well, that's so obvious." Yeah, but it was like she timed it perfectly, and I was like, "Thank you, you're right. That should be number one, right?" Yeah. You should
you
like who you're
to.
Hanging
it's
out.
It's helpful.
Yeah.
And I mean, we've all done jobs that, you know, aren't the greatest, but you just got to do what you got to do sometimes.
Yeah, sure.
And I think that's kind of what led us to farming and our journey. It's like I had worked a lot of jobs that I was really not happy with. My last job, I was about to quit, and actually we all got laid off, so that worked out. I mean, it's not great for everybody, but I was, you know, it was, things happen for a reason. I wholeheartedly believe that, and the journey you're on is meant to be the journey you're on. You always, if as long as you're learning something and progressing as a human, that's where you need to be, so.
Well put.
But, you know, farming, we don't do it for the money. Like, we do it for the love of what it is and the connection with the community and the food. And honestly, like, I can't imagine going back and working for somewhere else, for someone else. It would be really hard after, you know, having the freedom to, like, run my own thing.
Oh, yeah. And I think you, like, and Joey, you would, like, being a creative person also, like, empathize with this, or is that you're kind of, like, the idea really and anything you endeavor to do is to, like, cultivate an experience, whether it's for yourself or the people you care about. And I think, like, farming has definitely allowed us to do that. And, like, cooking is about that. Like, you have your friends over and you, like, you give your friends the best piece of meat, the best this, the best that, because it's, like, you care about them. You love them. And you're like, yeah, I'll eat again, whatever. Like, I did this because it's about us all coming together. Yeah, and I feel like that's where we've ended up with farming so far, and it's been really, really good. And every year we seek to, like, grow more experiences.
Beautiful.
Farm.
Yeah,
and open up those experiences to everybody.
Yeah,
like having more farm events. And
tell us about the farm events. I know you reached out one time. We didn't have the staff to do it, but what do those look like?
So
depends on the night.
Our goal is to just have things happening at the farm where people can come out and try the food, enjoy the food, and just get that fresh air in and be out in this countryside, which is, it's kind of, we're in a weird spot. We're right on the urban growth boundary. So it's like one street up, you have development everywhere. And then one street where we are mm-hmm. from that, it's like, it feels like you're in the middle of the countryside. It's crazy.
Yeah.
So we have a very beautiful spot. Mm-hmm. But you know, this year we're partnering with some of the other food producers to like have people come out to the farm and do like a Taco Tuesday.
Nice.
So Razo's, mm-hmm. Paul and Lindsay are going to come out and we'll do like a Taco Tuesday. Last year we did a Maui benefit, mm-hmm. trying to raise some money to send to Maui.
Right on.
So that's always, you know, fun. I love music. I'm huge on music. I'm a musician and mm-hmm. just trying to get some more music events happening.
Yeah.
Is definitely on the, I want that to happen. What else? Dinners, farm dinners. Mm-hmm. So.
Yeah. And I would say, like, yeah, like we do, ideally, we try to do, like, one fancy dinner every yeah. year.
Fancy
dinner. Yeah, so we did one last year, one fancy yeah. dinner, and it's, like
a full-on farm-to-table, like, multi-course three course meal. To five-course meal.
Yeah, and this was the first
paired
time.
Paired with beer and wine
yeah.
and drinks, yeah.
This was the first time we cooked for it, so that was pretty yeah. fun. And it was cool. small. It was, like, I think we had about 25 ticket purchases, and then we had another 5 or 10
That's
people.
A lot of people cook for.
Yeah, and so it was really good. But we used as many things from the farm as we could. Our seasonings we grew and dried, and all that. And the dessert was like we did a triple melon sorbet with a blueberry cinnamon basil gelato. And yeah. so it was like each melon sorbet was different.
Nice.
And then we grow these little silverberries, and those were studded in there. And yeah, try to make it super unique, like a one. And then we do fun, silly events like Kelly does. Like, not silly, but it's educational garlic braiding. And,
yeah, I do a lot of craft stuff, too.
Mm-hmm. Okay.
So I do a lavender craft class, a mm-hmm. garlic braiding class where you can come out. Usually you can harvest your own garlic, but it just depends on the seasonality mm-hmm. Or flowers. And then I teach you how to braid it together and make this beautiful thing you could take home and eat.
Beautiful.
If you want it.
Yeah.
You can
yeah.
also just dry it out. But,
exactly.
I want to try to get more educational classes going, like herbalism,
mm-hmm.
cooking classes even, which
yeah.
I think hopefully this year we'll be able to do. Like my vision is to have people come out, harvest their own produce, and then create something out of that they can eat
yeah.
at the farm.
Beautiful.
So that's kind of the plan for the year.
Mm-hmm.
Yep. And that'll be posted on our website.
Oh, yeah. The events are always posted online and all
yeah.
that. But, yeah, it sort of it really does depend on the night. We do want to do a lot more casual events mm-hmm. that are more mm-hmm. Financially approachable for people and can bring their families out and stuff. And that's why we only do one, like, fancy one, and it's – also, that's a lot of work. It's like a
yeah.
week of
yeah.
prep, and you're harvesting and washing and making sauces and then blending flavors. And
he doesn't give himself enough credit. He did, like, so much work for the last dinner. And
I might have chopped a bunch of cherry wood and smoked all the chickens with it.
Hand-smoked the chicken.
Yeah.
Brewed
I brewed the beer.
A saison mm-hmm. with our hops that we grow at the farm, and then the muscat grapes.
Yeah.
Oh, nice.
I carbonated it with
muscat
grapes.
Grape
juice. Ooh. Yeah, so.
The sorbets also,
yeah.
like super tasty.
Yeah.
Once a year,
pairings.
Right?
Yeah, once
yeah.
a year. Once go year. All out.
Gotta go all out.
Yeah, yeah. But if you ever come to one of our barbecues, they're not very different. They're they're fancy yeah. barbecues,
exactly.
yeah. Which we also like to try to do as well, because we have a disc golf course that our roommate put in. On the property now. So, yeah, we usually do like a... you know, hang out, some burgers. Always bet on black garlic burgers, and
black
to borrow a Bob's Burgers quote,
nice.
And then we'll throw around a disc, yeah, and just hang out, have some beers. It's pretty fun. Yeah.
Sounds delightful.
Yeah.
Right on.
Yeah.
Good. All the events are up here.
There's not a lot listed yet, but
yeah,
we get the dates
yeah.
set, we'll put them on our page.
All this
yeah.
stuff.
But that's all the shares you can buy. And
buttons
and yeah.
vegetables. Sign
yeah.
up.
And I think if you go to the top events, is there a... looks like they don't have the menu page there for some reason.
Hmm.
I've been updating the website, so it's like...
it
might not be showing up right now. I might have messed
button.
It up. Eventually, though, there will be a little tab that says events on there.
Yeah,
it looks a little weird right now.
That's all right.
That's funny. I was messing with it last night and trying to update
progress.
Some things, and it might have, like,
when you
glitched
go
it out.
It'll be up there.
It'll be there. It'll be there.
Find
yeah.
it on the website.
Or just hop
Instagram.
On our mailing, like,
once,
join our mailing list,
yeah, mailing
and
cool.
we always send out, like, a monthly newsletter that
cool.
has events and recipes, what's going on at the farm.
Mm-hmm.
We try to do a lot of educational stuff, too,
mm-hmm.
on there. Eventually, we'll get a blog going.
Yeah.
People still blog?
Right?
Cool.
I think for recipes, which recipes, I have a, she knows I have a love-hate relationship with food blogs. They're the most ad-ridden websites on the internet. Yeah. And so I always get frustrated, but I love that the information's out there. You just have to kind of suffer through the pop-ups. So.
The pop-ups, yeah. Well, and I guess right now the way we do it is our members get a weekly email with, this is what's going to be in your produce box, and this is how we typically cook it or store it or whatever we do with it, and then here's a recipe on what you can make with everything in your box. So,
because we do grow some unusual things that people have never seen. They're like, oh, okay, what do I do with
so
with
trying to like get people, you know, in on the experience of like how we cook with it and what you can do with it.
It's value added right there. You know, a lot of people, you know, get a kohlrabi and it's like, cool, it's a doorstop.
Cool, this looks neat, but what do I do with it?
Exactly.
Right.
What planet did this come from?
Exactly. Yeah. That's a lot of time and effort right there, putting that all together.
Yeah.
That's good you guys do that.
Yeah, and we try not to recycle too much. Try to, like, even with our recipes, it's like, oh, well, what do you like to make with it this year? Just, like, sit down. Okay. And you might just amend an old one, but it's a new take on it. And so, yeah, it's, but it's when it's something you like to do, it's fun. Yeah, there's no big deal. Yeah.
Agreed. And you get to eat it, too.
You get to eat it. You smell it and eat it.
Right on. Cool.
Yeah.
What else? Anything else you want to mention? It was a good, it was like a 3-hour talk. It was good.
Wow, that is long.
2.5 hours, maybe?
It's been a while.
Yeah, it was good.
I got nothing else that I can think of. Just a shout out and a, like, thank you so much for having
us. Thank you. Yeah, appreciate you all. That was great. Yeah, like I said, I believe you were on the original list of folks to have out. And just seeing you here last week, and I was like, boom, asking them.
Absolutely.
Cool. Appreciate that.
Yeah, we had to come out and support my brother, you know.
Yeah.
He's creative.
Mention that connection, too. Oh, that's a pretty cool thing.
Yeah, so my brother Laramie and his partner Dee, who owns Small Eats at the Vancouver Farmers Market, Laramie and I used to cook all the time together. So yeah, he and I lived on Long Island for a year, and like we worked in a kitchen out there, and just like, yeah, both have always liked to cook, make beer, and he's a good creative dude, and
Super passionate about what he does.
Sure. Yeah. Support him. He's always taking chances. I really appreciate that about him. He's like using unique, interesting ingredients and just trying new stuff. And it's really, really cool. And his kids are adorable. If you guys go to the farmer's market, you'll see him running around. Yeah. They're hilarious. Yeah. So
has he reached out to be like, hey, I really like this. Can you grow this for me?
So this year we should be growing him some like hearty Asian greens for pickling, because he does a lot of pickled Asian greens. And then he's also interested and has purchased like bok choy and things in the past and loves the cucumbers.
Does
painted serving cucumbers?
Nice. Yeah.
Those are like the top.
Beautiful. We've noticed like the Asian
and the
themed
Japanese cucumbers.
Oh, yeah. Mm-hmm. The vendors who do like Asian themed cuisine. So Josh from Cheering Your Cats with Cali Cantina. Loves the cucumbers. Laramie likes the cucumbers. Like, and so it's been really nice. Yeah, the market's a great hub for creativity. But it is really neat. I remember Laramie asking us, he's like, should we do the farmer's market? And we were like, yep.
Yep.
Do it.
100%.
Do it. It's like an incredible springboard. Yeah, he was like, after the first year, he's like, gave me a big hug. And he's like, thank you. He's like, that. He's like, it's been great. And I know he's a happier person doing this than what he used to do.
Yeah, 100%. So really,
they're going gangbusters, too.
Yeah, they're kicking butt. Good for them. Yeah.
Maybe some future stuff here as well.
Ooh, that would be fun.
On the back burner,
we'll see.
Yeah, it's something, you know, I tell people, you know, restaurant owners, I was like, I really like XYZ. I was like, where do you get it from? Blah, blah, blah. Have you talked to a farmer? Maybe they can grow it for you.
Yeah.
Yeah.
You know?
For sure. I mean, we're totally open to that. Yeah. And I've always told the chefs we work with, like, let us know.
Yeah.
If there's something you can't get, we will 100% grow it. And usually the answer we get, we like to just do whatever's seasonal. I'm like, yeah, I know. That's true. Mm-hmm. There's always being able to just create from what you've got is amazing. And it's a talent, big time. But yeah, like we are open to doing like any kind of contract growing or whatever it is you need.
Oh yeah. Cause like everyone else, we're still learning. So like something somebody asks for might be a total hit, and it might do great in our soil and kick butt. So like, why not take a chance? You know?
Yeah.
So yeah, we're open to suggestions.
Yeah. Some beautiful relationships. I mean, Row 7 Seeds, right? They had them in Stone Barns. They had all those collaborations, and now you can get honey flame badger beets all over the world.
Yeah, you never know. It's pretty cool. But yeah, we I guess Have we ever like custom grown anything for anyone else? I guess.
Yeah, the Calabrian chilies for Salaji.
Oh yeah, with your Calabrian chilies now. Joe Zimmerman grows them.
Because, we just couldn't do it on the scale that he.
Yeah, because Dave pumped out sauce, and we had a really bad year. And I was like, Dave, I'm sorry. We put in hundreds of plants, and the moles killed half of them. I replanted them. They killed them again, and then. You know, they didn't really pump the peppers that year. And so, but yeah, it's nice to know, like we had met Joe through a farmer happy hour we do every month.
Nice.
And so I gave, I think I gave one of them, the other person's contact info. And I was like, ask them, they got space. They can probably do it for you. And last year they grew them a ton of peppers and they're working happily together. So that's good to know.
Beautiful. Community and connections.
Yeah.
That's great. That's
we don't have to do it all. It's fine.
Exactly.
Yeah, we can't. You know who could do that? Yeah.
Outstanding. Cool. Super grateful for you guys. Yeah. Grateful for what you guys do. Joey. Good seeing you.
Yeah, as well.
Know your food, know your farmer. Thanks, guys.
Thank you.
Cheers.
What you see is what you get. It's what you get.